And welcome to Championship Football Friday. It is Dave Shannon with Chad States. We're here at Mansion Park getting ready for tonight's District 6 AAA Championship game between the Huntingdon Bearcats and the Forest Hills Rangers. I guess they're doing the anthem right now, so we'll turn the mic up from outside and you can catch the end of it. Sorry. One of the problems in being in a facility like this is the sound isolation between us and the fans is so good. I did not even know that they had started the anthem, so my apologies. I was not showing disrespect for the anthem or anything else that, you know, maybe people would think, nope, that's not me. And so, at any rate, just thought I would clarify that so that everyone knew that, we're on the up and up here. So welcome. And here we are. This is one of the things that you battle for as you go throughout the course of the season. And you make it to the championship game in your district. And you actually then hope to go further. What is it, Chad? There could theoretically be, what, 3-4 more weeks of this?
Yeah, this would. There's a quarterfinal, semifinal, and state final match after this. So you're looking at game after this. So you're looking at 3 more games after this one.
That's the idea. You want to get to that state championship, and you want to take advantage of these types of situations, Chad, because as high school football goes, it is not an easy thing to repeat.
No, they don't come around that often. Huntingdon is in a 12-year drought. The last time they were here was in 2005 when they defeated Belmont for the District 6 AAA title back then. Of course, that was a different District 6 AAA.
Right.
That was still under the 4 classification field. But that's the last time Huntingdon reached Mansion Park. For Forest Hills, it's been a little bit closer of a time period. They were here in 2012 and were blanked by Richland 27-0. It was a very good Richland school back then from down around the Johnstown area. So to your point, Dave, it's not easy to get here. But when you do get here, you want to take full advantage of it.
Well, the Forest Hills Rangers are taking the field, coming out from underneath the bleachers on the far side. We're on the home side of Mansion Park and getting ready to bring you tonight's game. And one of the things that Chad does a lot of work when it comes to the Bearcats, and he knows everything about the team and the history of the team and all that kind of stuff. And I was going over the stats and looking at things about these two teams. And one of the things that you look at, to a degree, there's a little bit of a mirror image between the two when you look at the offensive side of the football. And maybe the only difference is they use a number of running backs to achieve what Ian Border generally does on his own. That being said, it is still not the kind of team, and I'm talking about the Bearcats, that you can key in on one guy and hope to survive.
Right, and that, well, we saw that last week. Juniata tried to take away the Huntingdon running game, but could not single up or do anything with Jonathan Price. And, of course, he goes out and sets all kinds of school records receiving, and Andrew Hootie sets a single game school record passing the football as well, almost reaching the 300-yard mark, throwing for 298 and 3 touchdowns. So, yeah, you can't sing. You know, the only team that's been able to really do that to Huntingdon was Central. Central played a very tough football game against Forest Hills last week, almost a mirror image, Dave, to the same game that Huntingdon played against them. It was a 14-10 game deep into the fourth quarter. Forest Hills ended up driving and getting that winning touchdown, but it was a game that was very close to the Week 9 loss that Huntingdon had. So when you talk about these two teams mirroring each other, they even mirror each other in that game that is the only commonality between the two teams.
We're going to take a timeout, come back and talk to Coach Hootie, and we'll continue with our broadcast. It's the District 6 AAA Championship game with your Huntingdon Bearcats and the Forest Hills Rangers on theairnetwork.net and 94.1 FM in Huntingdon.
Call Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing for affordable heating, plumbing, and drain cleaning services in Huntingdon. Count on 12 years of insured excellent service when it comes to heating, plumbing, ventilation, and drain cleaning. Call Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing, available evenings and weekends at an affordable rate. Call 814-506-5128. That's 506-5128 for Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing in Huntingdon.
The Huntingdon Moose Family Center 223 is the heart of the community with loads of activities year-round.
The Huntington Moose Family Center 223 proudly sponsors social events for members and their guests. Plus, you can enjoy their Friday food specials starting at 5 p.m. every Friday. Check out an entertaining evening with the band Swamp Root Saturday, November 25th from 8 to 11 p.m. Check out our website for other exciting events coming up at the Huntington Moose Family Center 223, the heart of the community. Join us today.
Sometimes facts are hard to face. Statistics show that obesity is a problem in the United States, and it's not getting any better. At Simone Family Chiropractic, we understand this problem. We also know that obesity leads to very serious health problems later in life. There is a way to cleanse your body and get back to optimum health. It is called the doctor-supervised ChiroThin system. And it teaches you how and what to eat in the real world. Call us at Simone Family Chiropractic at 814-643-2616 or stop in and see us at 613 Washington Street in Huntington across from All American Pizza or find us on Facebook.
This is Ian Board. You're listening to Bearcat Football on the airnetwork.net.
Here are the head coach of the Huntington Bearcats as we get ready for the District 6 AAA championship game between the Bearcats and the Forest Hills Rangers. Coach Mike Hootie here with me. Coach, wanted to look back at last week's game and a convincing win over Juniata, but there were some things that probably perplexed you, one of which may have been penalties.
Yeah, we're constantly working on that. Our guys go after it, so they get excited and get carried away sometimes, and the one we're harping on is, you know, if the guy's gone by you, you don't need to block anybody.
Yeah, it's tough. A lot more holding penalties than I expected in last week's game, for sure. So one of the things that went really well for you, and I don't know, maybe this is just me and my observation, but it seemed to me that when Andrew Hootie got loosened up, started to complete a few passes, that changed the running game. You hear that a lot, that the passing game sets up the running game, vice versa. Do you think that was the case last week?
Absolutely. They're playing cover zero, cover one. I saw some cover two once in a while, but we took some shots and it worked and it loosened them up. And, you know, I mean, that's how it's supposed to work.
Somebody that's been a big plus here, and you've used him more and more as the season has progressed here to this point, and that's Drew Weglars as a running back. Chad States refers to him as a change of pace running back, and that's a good term because he is a completely different young man out there than what Ian Border is.
Yes, we like Drew's our most improved player. Hard worker, very intelligent, so he's a big asset.
Coming up tonight, a multi-pronged offensive attack from Forest Hills. And one of the things that you can do, I know the Steelers do this from time to time and have success. If you think you can put some pressure on a quarterback, you're going to change that passing game for a team. And I know Ben Briggs has been one of the guys that has been able to get in and harass the quarterback quite a bit. I would assume that's a point of emphasis for you guys tonight.
Yeah, we're going to go after it. I mean, there's no holds barred tonight. This is it.
Anything, we've talked about the playbook and how much it opens up or doesn't open up. Do you have anything that might be coming out tonight that we haven't seen?
Possibly.
Good answer. Well, Coach, it all comes down to this. Hopefully we're talking again next week as you move on in the playoffs into the postseason. And congratulations on a great season so far. Let's keep it going.
Thank you very much.
All right, we'll be back with the start of tonight's game. And we'll do that right after this timeout on the airnetwork.net and 94.1 FM Huntington.
D.C. Goodman & Sons and the Goodman family are committed and dedicated to excellence by supporting quality education and athletics for all youth of Huntington County. For over three generations, D.C. Goodman & Sons and their staff of quality tradesmen have provided excellent service in the installation of plumbing, mechanical and industrial piping, electrical, and fire sprinkler systems. Residential service are also available. D.C. Goodman & Sons and the Goodman family will continue to serve the community, and thank you for your support. The Goodman family wishes you the best to all area students in your pursuit of excellence.
I'm Owen Kaufman. You're listening to Huntington Bearcats on airnetwork.net.
And welcome back to Mansion Park in Altoona, set to kick off, and Forest Hills just about to approach the football, and the whistle blew.
I think that they had to wait till the time the pregame time expired there, Dave, for them to get going as Josh Jones is ready to kick it off, junior kicker for Forest Hills.
Approaches the ball, kicks it away, a line drive that hits at the 36-yard line is picked up by Jonathan Price out over the 20, 25, 30, and is going to be brought down at about the 32. Now, Jonathan, in true Jonathan Price form, continued to try to move forward, but he was eventually tackled there by the Forest Hills Rangers. First and 10, Bearcats ball. They mark him out of bounds at the 31-yard line. So here we go. And the Bearcats getting the ball on offense first. And this is going to be an interesting test right off the bat, Chad.
So let's see what we get.
I think Chad has unfortunately dropped out again. And he'll be back with us here in a second. Man in motion is Wagner. Going from left to right, the handoff goes to Ian Border. He is met in the backfield and brought down at about the 24-yard line. Let's see where they're going to say he got up to the 31. That's where his progress was stopped. The 29.
Drop him for a 2-yard
loss. So it's going to be a 2-yard loss. Bring up a second down and 12 for the Bearcats. So not the way you want to see your running game start.
Nope. And you can obviously see that motions are going to run high here in the early going. It's who's going to settle down and then settle into their game, Dave. It's going to decide this thing. Who's going to play mistake-free football?
Second down and 12. Hootie, of course, in the shotgun. Wagner going from right to left this time. Hootie rolls to his left, looks downfield, throws, and it's Jonathan Price, and he can't hang on. Price hit from behind, and he was hit by John Long of Forest Hills, and the ball popped out, so that is an incomplete pass, and now a third down and 12. Point is, I think about that play, Chad, is that Jonathan Price was open.
Yeah, and it was a rare drop by Jonathan as well, but Long coming up and hitting him from the back and jarring that ball loose. But, yeah, he was open, which is a good sign for the Bearcats, because if the passing lanes are open, they'll take advantage of that.
Third down and 12. First possession of the night, and official, the white hat says timeout. They stop the clock at 11:10. Goes over and talks to Jonathan Price, and he's going to take him off the field for an equipment chin strap, I think, might be the issue.
Yep.
So coming in to replace him is Draven Zook. Zook has a quick word for Andrew Hootie, and perhaps the play changed with Price coming off the field. Maybe not. Draven Zook has had some nice offensive numbers the last couple of weeks. Hootie rolling to his right this time, looks downfield, pocket collapses, and he's going to be dropped for a loss back to about the 26-yard line. And so it's going to be a fourth down and 15. So the first offensive possession for the Bearcats does not go well. Could have been a first down if Price would have caught the and been able to hold on to the football. He did have it, got hit from behind, like Chad said, and the ball popped out incomplete. Low snap to Hootie to punt. Gets it away. Little end over and hits and is picked up at the 36-yard line out to about the 43-yard line on the return. And that's a 7-yard return for the Forest Hills Rangers. They have the ball first and 10. So in the battle of field position early on, the Rangers come out victorious.
Yeah, and a good defensive early defensive sign there for Forest Hills as they were able to go ahead and get two plays with negative yardage on that series, Dave. Huntington's going to have to decidedly do something up front to try to block that a little bit better if they want to get the ball moving. But like you said, they had a first down converted. Just didn't happen.
First down and 10 at the 43 of the Rangers as they head toward the Huntington side of the field, moving from left to right here. And it's a pitch back. And that one is going to go for perhaps a loss. We're going to have to see where the forward momentum ends up leading the ball carrier, John Long, but Long is knocked back, and he's going to end up losing a yard.
Yep,
so it's going to be second down and 11. The down guy needs to fix that, and he did. Second and 11. The ball at the 42 now.
Both teams, Dave, come in here with offenses that have highly accredited skilled position players, Cesarian, Long on the Forest Hills side, along with Elgin. We know what Huntington brings to the table, but it's a defense early on that's showing the huge signs of life here for both teams.
Adam Cesari, the quarterback, 6'4", 220, rolling to his right. Looks downfield, lets it go. Pass complete to Long at the 39-yard line of the Bearcats for a Rangers first down. Nice play And it was a good job by the quarterback, Adam Cesari, to buy enough time to allow Long to get into an open area there and be able to catch that pass. And they're into Huntington territory.
Well, that's the danger with Forest Hills is Long coming out of the backfield. He's their leading receiver and their leading rusher on the year. If these two are going to play pitch and catch all night long, it's going to be a long night for the Bearcats. They've got to close that route down. They've got to shut Long down.
By the way, if you would like to watch the game on TV, just turn your TV sound down and keep it with us. Here's a big pass from Cesari toward the end zone. Oh, over the shoulder and not caught. It was right there. Forrest Wolfhope could not come up with the football. Good defense by Jairus Warner going down the sideline. And just unable to connect, but I'll tell you what, is that an impressive pass or what?
I mean, a corner pass, a deep corner pass like that by Cesari. Again, you know, we know he's a Division I baseball player in the coming years. He's already committed to Wake Forest. But, Dave, that was a great throw. Wolfo had a step on Warner as he actually kind of pulled away from him, and Cesari put it right where he had to, just right through his hands.
By the way, we'd like to thank the Altoona area school district for putting the lights on at Mansion Park in an effort to try to distract the young man who plays baseball, Mr. Cesari, who completes a little flare pass down over the 20 to 10. Touchdown! It looked like that play was going to be over at about the 31-yard line, but instead, John Long, that big connection that Chad was talking about, that one is complete, and in there is a flag at the 14-yard line of the Bearcats.
Let's see if this is an illegal
block.
There may
have been a bad
block.
Yep, block in the back is called against Forest Hills, but the completion's going to count. And they'll mark this back from the point of the foul, which once again is the 14-yard line. And everybody getting organized. But those fans over on the far side, by the way, Forest Hills traveling very well as our Huntington Bearcat fans who are here in good numbers for tonight's game.
Yeah, pretty much an equidistant trip for both teams to be able to make it here. So this being a great venue to play a championship football game, and everybody's come out to take a look at it. Not as cold of a night as what it was last week, Dave.
Yes, and we have no wind. We had talked about that. That's going to be a big plus for these offenses. They're on turf, no wind. Yeah, it's cold, but that's what you expect in November. That takes the ball back to the 24-yard line of the Bearcats and takes the points off the board. That's a plus. Adam Cesari looks to his left, options, and keeps. Goes down over the 15, stumbles a bit, and then falls forward to about the 11-yard line. The gain's good for another Forest Hills first down.
And that was just an inside read there by Cesari. He had a pitch man out to the right, but he decided just to tuck and run it right up the middle and pick up 12 yards on that. So another first down for Forest Hills.
8:49 left to go in the first quarter. No score in the game between Huntington and Forest Hills on the airnetwork.net and 94.1 FM in Huntington. First and 10. They can get a first down without going into the end zone. The ball at the 11. Cesari in the shotgun. Takes the snap, and it's a quick handoff, and that is going to be a touchdown. Forest Hills eventually gets it in as Eric Elgin carries the ball in for a Forest Hills touchdown. And one of the things about Forest Hills, you have three guys that will be running the football at different times for Forest Hills, so you can't come into this game and prepare for one. You got to prepare for all three. 6-0, Rangers with the lead. Forest Hills will now attempt the point after. Spots down, the kick is up, and I think it's no good. Nope, wide to the right. So the point after is no good, and that will force Forest Hills, if they get the ball and are able to score again, to have to go for two. But Josh Jones ends up slicing that one to the right, and the score remains Forest Hills 6 and the Bearcats nothing.
I'd say, Dave, this is a perfect start for Forest Hills. I'm coming out, you know, putting Huntington into a punting situation, a quick three and out, then getting the ball back and marching right down the field and scoring a touchdown and putting the Bearcats in a hole. Now, we've seen Huntington in a hole before. Early on against Juniata, they were down 14-0, and you know, we looked at each other like, well, how are they going to respond? And they were able to respond. This Huntington team has a great deal of resolve. They have all year long. So being down 6-0, again, to the class of to the caliber of football team that Forest Hills is, isn't a surprise. I really think that Huntington's going to find themselves and dig themselves right out of this right now.
Well, one of the things that happened last week against Juniata, Chad, was it was a slow start as we had to have a couple of possessions. Now, maybe you wanted to attribute that to the week off, the bye week, but that being said, the Bearcats have touched the football once. They have a little better feel for the game, and now they're going to get the football a second time, and this is going to be a critical possession for the Bearcats. Down at about the 12-yard line, it's Jonathan Price to our left and Jacob Wagner to our right.
The thing I didn't like to see was Forest Hills dominated the trenches on both of those series. And on the defensive side and the offensive side, Huntington's really going to have to clean that up if they want to stay in this football game.
And we have a TV delay going on right now as the kicker, Josh Jones, was all set and ready to go, but they had to wait for commercials to be completed. They have been, and he tees the ball up at the 40-yard line. We're set to go. He tees it to the left hash mark. And we'll see if he tries to keep it away from Price and go to Wagner. That's double poison back there.
Yeah, it sure is.
Take your pick. Kicks it off right toward the middle of the field, fielded by Price at the 16, 25, 30, 35, 40. And he is just ripped down by Jake Shope on special teams. If Shope didn't get him, he was about to go by the kicker, Josh Jones, and would have had a clear path to the end zone. But Price ends up fielding the kickoff and ripping it up the middle of the field. There was no wasted energy on that return.
And Dave, we've said if you're gonna play against this Huntington team, you got to be ready for all three phases. And the special teams, that's Price on a 39-yard kickoff return that time. So it's electrifying.
First and 10, Bearcats ball at the 46, 6-0, Forest Hills with the lead. Ian Border looked like he was going to be able to make some yardage that time. He did, but not what I thought he was going to get because he was tripped up and tackled by Eben Coonrod.
Gain of 2 that time for Ian Border. Going into this game, Dave, I thought one of the keys of the game was going to be how did Huntington run the football. I really think they have to establish the run against this tough Forest Hills defense to really be in this football game. They've got to run the football better than what they have.
Last week was the case where the pass set up the run,
right.
So we'll see if that happens this week as well. Hootie in the shotgun, fakes the handoff to Border, and now the pocket is collapsing. He is chased down by Nick Perriton of Forest Hills. The sack of Andrew Hootie as he goes down for the second time on a sack. And now it's a third down and 16 for the Bearcats.
That was a big sack that time. And this is what concerns me is the Forest Hills defensive front is beating the Huntington offensive front to the step right now. That's a second sack on a quarterback, and it's the second third and long situation Huntington's been in this game. And this can't continue for Huntington to have success tonight.
You talk about a guy that's put together, Perriton, 5'9", 215. That's a big young man coming at you. Andrew Hootie goes deep down the sideline for Jonathan Price to the left, and the pass is overthrown and incomplete, and it brings up a fourth down for the Bearcats. So second possession and another three and out, and the Bearcats are going to have to stop that because if Forest Hills can take a second possession right down the field and score, it's going to be a long night for the Bearcats.
I agree. This is not, this is a very good football team. But, to reiterate, Forest Hills' only loss is to Bishop Guilfoyle.
And not by that much.
Not by that much.
There's a spiraling kick that the return team lets go, and it ends up rolling down at the 11-yard line. So that's where Forest Hills will take over, first and 10. So the Bearcats at least have them pinned down in their own end rather decently. But I'll tell you what, if you can start hitting those long passes, that being pinned deep doesn't mean a whole lot.
No, it was a nice 41-yard punt there. They got some roll to put it down near the 10-yard line, Dave. And it's important that they're going to give Forest Hills a long field this time. So Huntington, the defense actually has time to breathe here a little bit.
First and 10, Forest Hills ball at their own 11. They lead the game by a score of 6-0 with 6:39 left to go in the first quarter. Handoff out over the 14 to about the 16-yard line. The ball carrier. Was that long or
no,
not?
No, I think it was Elgin.
Not.
It was Elgin on the carry.
Elgin with the carry. Eric Elgin, 6'206". Talk about your fullback size.
7 yard pickup that time.
So he does get out to the 18-yard line, a little bit further than what I had thought. And it is second down and short. Don't want to be giving this team too many second and shorts. Here's a quick handoff again, and met at the 19-yard line, short of the first down this time, is the ball carrier. And once again, that is Eric Elgin. Elgin does pick up a yard, but it brings up a third down and two. And, boy, you talk about rug-cutting time for your defense. This is it right here.
Absolutely. And you can make a statement because you can make them punt deep in their own territory to a dangerous Jonathan Price, the punt returner for Huntington, if you're able to get the stops. This is a big stop here for Huntington. Big third down for Huntington coming up.
Three guys up on the line for the defense for the Bearcats. Back to pass is Cesari. And the pass is intercepted.
And that was the receiver never turned to look at the football. Andrew Finkel stepped right in front of the receivers. He just kept on going. He was doing a post pattern. Andrew Finkel, the all-conference safety, stepped right in front of the receiver, and Cesari never saw him. And he was able to pick off that football at the 32 and bring it all the way back to the Huntington 23.
I'll cut Adam Cesari a break because I had a post right in front of me, so I couldn't even see who intercepted the ball. I just knew that everyone started running in the direction of the Forest Hills end zone, and the Bearcats are blessed now on that big third down with great field position, first and 10. At their own 20, or at the 23 of Forest Hills. There's a keep by Hootie. Design play continues to run and is eventually tripped up at the 10-yard line. Andrew Hootie with a first down, tripped up and tackled by Nick Perriton.
It's going to be close. We'll see where they're at. Yep. They're going to move the chains. Yeah, it's right at the 13, so it's a 10-yard pickup for Andrew. You win, and we are good to go. We know sometimes we get fooled by the refs,
yes,
so
do.
We just want to be careful. But, yes, that's a first down run. And now you're starting to see momentum shift here a little bit towards Huntington based on that turnover.
You know, it's good to see the team react in this kind of way after getting that big turnover. There's a handoff, goes to Ian Border, tries the right side. He's down over the 10, still going, and is brought down at about the 8-yard line. That'd be a gain of 5 and a second and 5 for the Bearcats.
And I would say that you are in 4-down territory right now. I know we have a capable kicker in Giovanni Scotchi, but with Forest Hills coming out and putting 6 on the board right off of the bat, you want to get a touchdown here.
Clock rolling, just under 4.5 left to go here in the first quarter, and a 6-0 Forest Hills lead. Bearcats are dressed, by the way, in their home unis, if you're familiar with those. And now a shift. This is going to be some Wildcat stuff to Ian Border. Border bounces off the pile and then is tackled in the backfield. What nice pursuit that time by Shane Sikora of Forest Hills to bring Ian Border down for a loss back to the 12-yard line.
Yeah, that was just an outstanding play that time by Sikora. He snuffed that out right away and just came on the backside. Border made a step, tried to get to the outside, and Sikora was there to take him down.
With a big loss, it sets up a third down and 9. Of course, as Chad said, you can expect that this is perhaps going to be 4-down territory, so let's see what happens first. Hootie is back to pass, looks across the middle, post pattern incomplete. He hit Jacob Wagner right in the gut, and Jacob could not hang on to it, and that's 2 Bearcat receivers that have had the pass delivered in pretty decent area and unable to hold on to the football. So credit the defense of Forest Hills, and Coach Hootie is going to opt for Gio Scotia in a field goal attempt of 29 yards.
And this is a smart move. Based on the receivers dropping the football early on here, this is the smart move.
6-0 Forest Hills with the lead. 3:35 left to go. First quarter. The snap, the kick, it's up. It is good. No good. No good. It went to the left. Wide left. Had the height, had the distance, and just missed by a bit. I thought I saw the ball going in front of that left upright, and indeed that is the case. So the ball will go over to Forest Hills after the failed field goal attempt, and they will start from their 20-yard line.
And the Huntington offense has to be scratching their heads on that one, as they had the opportunity to punch in a score here, to take the lead, and were unable to do so. Big missed opportunity for the Bearcats, Dave.
Yeah. Hopefully it's not one they regret. You don't want to leave points on the field, and they just did, three of them. 3:31 left to go, first quarter. Fakes the handoff. Ciceri tries to go over the left side of the line, and the Bearcats were ready for that as four Bearcats took Ciceri back and dropped him. No gain in the play in a second and 10.
Yeah, and Forest Hills is quickly finding out that there's not a lot of running room out there with this Bearcat defense. They had a little success in that first drive, but their last three runs have all been for negative yardage or no yardage at all. So Cesare's going to have to get this done through the air, completely capable of doing so.
Cesare in the shotgun, and he's going to hand the ball off. Eluding one tackler, then out over the 25 to the 30-yard line. The gain's good for a first down. And that was Eric Elgin once again carrying the football as he picks up the Forest Hills. No, he's short. They mark him short by a half yard. Third down and a half yard.
If it's even that, it's you just never know sometimes where these guys are going to spot the ball.
That's kind of interesting. One of the things that happens if you are a fan of the NFL and you watch that, there's a lot of generous spotting of the football in the NFL, and you start to think that every football game you watch is going to be that way, and it's not always the case. It's going to be a quarterback keep and a first down, so it was going to come eventually, and it did, as Ciceri keeps and gets the first down for the Rangers out over the 32-yard line, first and 10. So you have to give him a gain of three, since it was third down and a yard, which was actually less. But statistically, he gets three.
He gets three.
2 minutes left to go, first quarter, 6-0. Forest Hills with the lead. Forest Hills in their road white tops with green pants and the numbers in green, trimmed in gold, and of course they have the Green Bay Packer look with their helmet and the R for Rangers. Going across the field and catching the pass is John Long, and then diving forward for a first down. Ryan Corey ends up tackling him, but some nice direction there as Long came off the left side of the line, cut across, and then the little screen pass over to him, and that's good for another Forest Hills first down.
And he's the weapon that Forest Hills wants to use in this football game. He's the leading receiver, the leading rusher, the all-everything player besides Ciceri, and they've got him heated up. He's got three catches for 56 yards already in the game.
First and 10, the ball at the... Chad, I accidentally had that power go out again. Quarterback is back to pass, looks downfield, and completes to a safety valve who gets down over the 30 of Huntington and is bumped out of bounds at about the 34.
Jake Shope.
Jake Shope, the junior. He's 5'8", buck 60, and he was the safety valve on that play, and he ends up catching the ball. And... running it a good ways. He had quite a few yaks after that.
Yeah.
As he gets down to the Bearcats, 26 is where he's marked out of bounds. First and 10, Forest Hills in danger of putting another one in the end zone. A minute 11 left to go here in the first quarter. A 6-0 Rangers lead. Here's the handoff, and this one goes to Jake Shope, and Shope gets up to about the 25. It's going to be a gain of one and a second down of 9.
Well, the Huntington defense is really going to have to tighten up here, Dave. They can't allow another score, specifically one before the end of the quarter, but they can't allow another score to happen here. They've got to shut down Forest Hills in this series.
By the way, thanks to the anonymous Bearcat alumnus, Deb Kramer and SCF of Sharpsburg, Georgia, and Huntington Bearcat Football Booster Club. They made contributions tonight to the broadcast for the PIAA broadcast fees, and that's why we're here tonight. Here's a pass and a flag on the play. The pass is complete to Long from Ciceri, and he's tackled down around the 12-yard line, but let's see what the flag is, if it may be a false start against Forest Hills, because it was right around the line of scrimmage where that flag was thrown.
Sure seems like it's going to be offensive, Dave.
Discussion between the white hat and the line judge. Is that an illegal shift
is what it looks
against
like.
Forest Hills? And, of course, the Bearcats are going to take that penalties. Clock stopped at 27, by the way.
Got to wipe out a 13-yard pass play from Ciceri to Long again, but Huntington's really going to have to solve that puzzle because Long cannot continue to get open like this and Huntington survive this football game. He's just way too good of a receiver for that to happen.
Ball back at the 29-yard line. They need to get down to the 16, so it'll be second down and 13. 4-4 is still. And a timeout called by Forest Hills before this quarter comes to an end. I want to remind you the Pitt Panthers travel to face the Virginia Hokies tomorrow afternoon. The Air Network will have the action. Tune in at noon for the pregame show, followed by kickoff at 12:20, courtesy of the Pitt IMG Sports Network here on theairnetwork.net and in Huntington on 94.1 FM. Also, I want to thank the Bearcat Broadcast Boosters for bringing you tonight's District 6 title game. Thanks to the Huntington Moose Family Center, 223, D.C. Goodman & Sons and the Goodman Family, All-American Pizza and Subs, Simone Chiropractic and Weight Loss, and Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing for supporting a great season of football on the Air Network and 94.1 FM in Huntington. Have a score coming in from Greg Banks back at the Air Network Studios. Bishop Guilfoyle, 21, Juniata Valley, nothing. That's after one quarter of play.
And that's all we have to say about that.
Yeah.
And that's nothing against the folks from Juniata Valley that are listening to us.
27 seconds left here, and the Bearcats want to keep this first quarter score at 6-0 here. Second down and 13. And in motion is Long. Ciceri takes the snap, looking for Long, down the right side, throws a wobbler. Oh, my! Jairus Warner looked like he was settled under that, Chad, like a kick returner waiting for the ball to come down.
That was like a duck floating up there that Ciceri threw. I don't know if it came out of his hand wrong or what, but
he had
Long open because Long ran a great wheel route right along the corner here, right along the right sideline, and was actually beyond Warner. If that ball is thrown well, that's a touchdown for Forest Hills. But another missed opportunity for the Bearcats is that was an interception that should have been had and a turnover.
Pass incompletion brings up a third down and 13. Still 20 seconds left to go. Back to pass, Ciceri looks down the left side this time, throws it deep, and it's caught for a touchdown.
Nope,
he dropped it. Boy, I thought that Forrest Wolfhope had reeled that one in, but he did not, and it bounced out of the end zone and out of bounds, and it sets up a fourth down.
Yep.
And 13.
I think they're poised to go for it here. Dave, early on, the difference that I see between this year's game versus last year's game is pressure. Huntington was able to get a lot of pressure on Ciceri last year. They're not able to do that right now, as he's able to set up in his pocket and make throws to whoever receiver that he wants to throw it to, and Huntington's got to start getting the pressure on.
Ciceri in the shotgun, Elgin back there to block for him. Now Elgin releases and starts down the field. Instead, Ciceri tries a pass. It goes incomplete, intended for, yeah, you guessed it, John Long. It's almost an automatic.
Yep.
When he goes back to pass, have your eye on Long because the ball's going to be somewhere near him.
But a big hold that time by the Bearcat defense. That penalty hurt Forest Hills in numerous ways. But a big hold that time by the Bearcat defense as they will take over now for their third possession of the ball game here on their own 29-yard line.
This is a statement possession, to say the least, for the Bearcats. Their third, or is it their fourth possession of the night?
I think it's their third.
Third. And the last time they were blessed with extremely good field position, courtesy of an interception. 7 seconds left to go in the first quarter. Pass is complete to Wagner over on the right side, and Wagner is met immediately, and he does not even get back to the line of scrimmage. He'll lose a yard, and time will expire in the first quarter. It is the District 6 AAA Championship game, and the score at the end of the first quarter, Forest Hills 6 and Huntington nothing. Back with more after this on theairnetwork.net and 94.1 FM Huntington.
Call Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing for affordable heating, plumbing and drain cleaning services in Huntington. Count on 12 years of assured excellent service when it comes to heating, plumbing, ventilation, and drain cleaning. Call Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing, available evenings and weekends at an affordable rate. Call 814-506-5128. That's 506-5128 for Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing in Huntington.
Sometimes facts are hard to face. Statistics show that obesity is a problem in the United States, and it's not getting any better. At Simone Family Chiropractic, we understand this problem. We also know that obesity leads to very serious health problems later in life. There is a way to cleanse your body and get back to optimum health. It is called the Doctor Supervised ChiroThin System, and it teaches you how and what to eat in the real world. Call us at Simone Family Chiropractic at 814-643-2616 or stop in and see us at 613 Washington Street in Huntingdon across from All American Pizza or find us on Facebook.
Hi, this is Coach Hootie. The Huntingdon Bearcats are on the airnetwork.net.
Well, the play to Jacob Wagner is ending up being called a no-gainer, so it's going to bring up a second down and 10 for the Bearcats. In a pretty crucial part of the football game as we start the second quarter, and the offense just not having any success at all to this point. How many yards do we have as a team?
Three yards.
So if you know much about this Bearcat football team, you know that that is a really serious point of concern.
Yes.
At this point in the football game. So let's see if the Bearcats can get it going. They've been out there. They have a feel for what the Rangers are doing defensively. Let's see if they can turn that into some big positive yardage for the Bearcats. Hootie in the shotgun. Takes the snap, quarterback run, and he's going to be stacked up in the backfield. That play is not working for the Bearcats, and they're going to end up marking him for no gain, and it'll bring up a third down and 10.
It'll be their third and long so far this game, Dave, and this is just, again, not a situation that Huntington can find themselves in at all. First quarter, Forest Hills had 122 total yards of offense, Huntington with three, so... Not the way you want to see the yardage spell out here.
The fortunate thing is, Chad, that it's 6-0.
Right.
So the Bearcats have been able to keep them off the board. They did give up the one touchdown. Could have had a touchdown on their last possession. Wolf Hope could not hold on to the football. Here's a pass that was intended for Ben Briggs right down the middle of the field, and it's knocked back by one of the Forest Hills defenders. I did not catch who that was, but he got his paw up there and batted it right back to Andrew Hootie.
I think it was number 71, Lucas Williams, a senior defensive tackle, 6'4", 310 pounds. So a pretty big arm to go ahead and stick that up as Hootie will now.
What the heck are they feeding those kids over there?
I don't know, but they're pretty big. This is Hootie's third punt of the evening.
6'4", 310. You've got to be kidding me. Nice punt by Andrew Hootie, but
it goes way out of bounds.
He ended up shanking it over to the left. Off his foot, it goes out of bounds, and it's not going to be a very long punt at all as they mark it at the 46-yard line of Forest Hills. And for a team that's been doing well offensively, you don't want to hand the ball to them at that point on the football field.
No, and that just becomes a 35-yard punt. It looked like it was going to go a lot further, and it did, but it just went out of bounds. As you're right, he shanked that off his foot, and now it sets up Forest Hills with good field position at their 46.
By the way, coming up at halftime, we will have an interview for you. Greg Banks doing the honors. So stay tuned for that. It is Teresa Hawbaker, director of the Huntingdon Community Center, discussing the programs available to area youth. That's at halftime of tonight's game. Right now, we have 11 minutes and 4 seconds left on the play clock to get there, and we're being held up by television once again. The Rangers ready to go, so are the Bearcats, and we have to wait until I don't see the field director, or I'd be looking down there for the gigantic white glove or bright orange glove or whatever. I do not see a field director down there, but maybe they've gone to direct communications.
Could be.
By the way, I want to thank the Altoona Area School District for providing us with such a great place to broadcast a football game. Delayed handoff and met in the backfield and ripped down that time by Ben Briggs was Eric Elgin. Elgin has had his way with the Bearcat defense, and that time Briggs was in their playbook.
Yeah, it's a 2-yard loss as Ben just come off of his end position and just tracked Elgin down and dropped him for that 2-yard loss.
An important play.
Huntington needs to continue trying to get through this Forest Hills line because they've not had a lot of success at it.
I had looked for Briggs to have a big game because I looked for them to try to do some pressure on the quarterback. Here's a pass complete. The long met immediately and dropped by Alex Mikett for another loss. All right, here comes the D. Yes. All we need is to get the O in shape.
So that's a two-yard loss for long on that pass play from Cesari, and it's going to set Forest Hills up in a third and long. Now, you know, Huntington's got to be careful of that long pass play here, specifically that one to Wolfolk that has failed twice but has been there twice.
Keep your eye on Wolf Hope or Long. Pick your poison with those two guys. Third down, 14. Ball at the 42 of the Rangers. Here is the quarterback, Cesari, rolling to his right, letting it go deep downfield. And Jairus Warner with the defense knocks it away from Wolf Hope that time. As that one was a jump ball, yep. And the winner was Jairus Warner.
The ball went where I thought it was going to go, which was right to Wolfolk, but stride for stride was Jairus Warner. And he did a great job of turning around and positioning his body towards Wolfolk. So even if that ball got close to him, Wolfolk really didn't have a chance of catching that football. So great job that time by Jairus Warner. And Forest Hills is now going to have to punt to the dangerous Jonathan Price.
Jairus Warner with a little bit of an advantage when it comes to height against Wolf Hope. 6'2 is Jairus Warner, and Wolf Hope comes in at 5'10. So, got to like that matchup as far as the Bearcats defense. Here's a pop-up on the punt. It's going to hit at the 32, but takes a good roll for Forest Hills. Nope. Is fielded by Price. He started to run, but I think he had his hand up in the air.
He did.
They interpreted that as a fair catch. And now Jonathan holds the face mask on his helmet and looks up to the sky and goes, what was I thinking?
And this is right to call. He's going to get a penalty called on this, too, because you can't signal right, trying to run the football. Right. And that's a mistake for, you know, if you're at the college level and you're at the professional level, you got to know better than to do that. But here at the high school level, this isn't something that happens all the time. It's not something that they see. So they are going to get tagged with a 5-yard penalty on this because of Jonathan trying to run the football after he signaled for the fair catch.
So the Bearcats will start at their own 19, first and 10, 6-0. Forest Hills with the lead, 9:41 left to go in the first half of tonight's District 6 Triple-A Championship game.
And just like the Central game so far, Price held in check. No carries, no catches right now through this football game.
I think this might loosen up a bit. Let's see. Hootie hands off to Border. Border goes right up the gut, and he ends up getting some decent positive yardage, gets over the 20, brought down at the 22-yard line. I'll give him a gain of 3 and bring up a second down and 7.
I'll concur with that.
I have no official position here to be doing that. But
I'll concur with that gain of 3. But they really got to get this running game going. Again, I'm just concerned with what I'm seeing at the line of scrimmage and how Forest Hills is completely taking control of this. This is very, very reminiscent of the Central football game that we watched a couple weeks ago, Dave.
Well, we remember how much the Wildcat came into play in that game. And you had Border, and here's a pass to Jairus Warner out around the 27, over the 30, up to 35. Spin move continues to roll up to the 40-yard line. What a nice catch and run by Jairus Warner. Some nice yak yardage. And that's been maybe the most positive play for the Bearcat offense all night.
It is. It's a 19-yard pickup and a first down. And maybe it's time to look and see who else is available out there to try to loosen things up. They have Warner. They have Wagner. They have Draven Zook. They have their tight ends, Mikan and Briggs. Try to get the ball somewhere else to loosen it up for these playmakers to do something.
Which game was it that Mikan had such success in? Was that Central as well?
That was Central, yeah.
Yeah. Well, let's see what happens. Man in motion as Border stops, goes back, takes the ball from Andrew Hootie in the backfield, and then tries to go over the left side. And once again, not much doing there for Ian Border. They'll give him a gain of a yard and a second down and one. But the running game, I think the Bearcats are going to have to look at stretching the Rangers as much as they can, because if you're trying to keep it in the middle of the field, these young men are ready.
Either that, or if you're going to keep it in the middle of the field, why don't you line up with two tights, throw an I formation out there. Yep. Dave, we've seen them have success out of the eye. Line it up and let's see what you get, because now you're going to involve the Forest Hills linebackers when you start doing that, and I think Huntington can expose that if they went to that type of formation.
Just under 8 minutes left to go here in the first half. 6-0, Forest Hills with the lead. It's a keeper by Andrew Hootie, who fooled no one. Faked the handoff to Ian Border, kept the football, tried to turn it upfield, and there just wasn't anything there for Andrew. I'm going to say no gain. at this point. So it's going to be a third down and 9. And so the Bearcats need to dial up something. Andrew Miller comes in with a play from the sideline. And let's see if maybe it's an Alex Mike.
Well, maybe. This is Huntington's 5th third down attempt, and all of them, Dave, have been 9 yards or longer. So third and long is the theme of the game so far for the Bearcats, and it's not something they want to be doing.
Miller's on the near side here, which is the right side for Hootie, along with Price. And Hootie looks down the field. It's intercepted by Ciceri. He's over midfield, 40, 35, and is eventually pulled down and out of bounds on the far side of the field by Ryan Corey. So Corey takes him out of bounds, but not after an ill-advised pass, because there were two Bearcat receivers in the vicinity of that pass. The problem was there were three Forest Hills defenders, and credit quarterback Adam Ciceri with the interception.
Yeah, he threw into double coverage that time. He didn't really he didn't look off of his receiver, and it was a pretty easy pick for Forest Hills, and it sets him up in a great field position here.
So the Bearcat defense called upon again to try to stiffen up here. It's going to be Ciceri on the keep. He gets down over the 35 to perhaps the 32-yard line. That would be a gain of a couple. And a second down and 8. So credit to the Bearcat defense for being able to keep this running game somewhat at a minimum here. The big danger with Forest Hills so far in tonight's game has been passing.
Yeah, and that doesn't come as a surprise to me. Specifically what we saw last week with Huntington controlling the Juniata running game is they're pretty good at shutting that stuff down. But they've got to play smarter football and give themselves a better chance on some of these third downs and second downs as opposed to what they're doing so far.
6:15 left to go in the first half. Snap, Ciceri back, out of the shotgun, throws a post pattern, and it's incomplete again. We've had a number of receivers hit right in the hands, and in this case it was Forest Hills receiver.
Well, the passing game has been there for both teams, Dave.
Yeah.
Surprisingly, you know, you've seen Huntington have three that drops on the evening, okay. And that was long on that.
And you don't expect that as no. many passes as Long has caught this no. year.
And he dropped that. I mean, that ball was thrown perfectly, hit him right on the fingertips, stride for stride, and he dropped the football.
Shout out to Dory Fortson, who is tuned into Bearcat Football on the Air Network, along with Mike Reiling. Once again, thanks to Mike and Dory. Here's Ciceri back to pass, throws another wobbler, and what timing by Jairus Warner to come in and hit the intended receiver, Evan Coonrod, and it falls incomplete.
And we are seeing Warner play a great cornerback here today.
Right now, you can hand him the game ball.
Yeah, that's three pass breakups for Jairus and an interception that he should have had down here too.
Yeah.
So he's really, really coming alive here and helping to secure this Huntington defense.
Clock stopped at 6 minutes, and Forest Hills going for it on fourth down. You would expect this with the ball at the 32 of the Bearcats. And almost sacked was the quarterback, and instead the pass is incomplete. Coonrod, once again, the intended receiver, just unable to bring it in. And some good pressure by the Bearcats. I was hoping for the sack. That didn't happen. So the Bearcats inherit the football with really decent field position at their own 32-yard line, first and 10. And this is rug-cutting time. This offense has to show us something here.
They've got to get going, Dave. The defense is proving their worth out here. They're getting the stops when they need to. They're setting up the offense with decent field position. But Huntington has to do something on offense and solve this puzzle that Forest Hills is throwing at them right now.
5:54 left to go in the first half. 6-0 Forest Hills with the lead. Bearcats with the football. And there's your change of pace guy, Drew Weglars. And he busts loose for about an 8-yard gain out near the 40-yard line. They're going to mark him back at the 39 because they're not as generous as the NFL officials. So we'll give him a gain of 7 on that and set up a second down and 3.
Well, the two biggest plays for the Bearcats so far come with two players that you don't see a lot of tape on. And I think maybe that's what they're going to have to start to look at to try to loosen up these other playmakers that Huntington has, is to just get it out there to Warner and to Weglars and Wagner and some of these guys that don't normally touch the football.
And there's Hootie with the pitch. It goes to Weglars, and he's taken out about short of the line of scrimmage, so there'll be a loss of about 1 on that play. And now we'll go to a third down and 5. Third and five for the Bearcats.
And what I'm seeing, Dave, is tremendous pressure pressure from the defensive front from Forest Hills. They're getting great penetration in against Huntington. So these plays that Huntington are trying to run that are taking a long time to develop aren't able to develop because of the penetration Forest Hills is getting on them. They're going to have to find something with a faster rhythm to get them going.
Bryce is wide to the left right here on the near sideline. Hootie back to pass. Has an emergency outlet in Weglars. A wobbler down the middle of the field is caught. Price, 20, 15, 10. Touchdown, Jonathan Price. A bit of a wobbler thrown up by Andrew Hootie, but the athleticism of Jonathan Price. How many times have we seen him jump up and make a catch like that this year, Chad?
Well, we just saw it again, and you want to talk about the miracle of Mansion Park. That might be what that play becomes here, is that ball really had no chance of winding up in Price's hand. That was a complete wobbler, a complete floater. Andrew didn't get a really good chuck on that football, and Price came back and made a great catch, colliding with the defender. The defender goes down, Price doesn't, and he scampers for a 63-yard touchdown.
When you look up Wounded Duck on Wikipedia, there's a video of that. Bad snap back on the point after attempt. Warner makes a pass attempt, and he tries to go to Weglars, who's knocked down by one of the Forest Hills defenders, and the flag comes in, so the Bearcats are going to get a second try at this.
Yep, absolutely. And that's a bad penalty for Forest Hills.
I think that may have been Shane Sikora.
It could have been.
Who committed the foul there, knocking Weglars to the ground.
So now that allows you to go ahead and line up and try and kick again.
And pass interference is the call. That's called out by the white hat. And, of course, the Bearcats get the second attempt now at the point after. Still going to be... I'll tell you what, that's... We were talking about Warner, and Warner, if there's a guy to get a game ball, it's got to be Warner. And now, with the penalty, I guess there's maybe the thought that you should go for two at this point. I don't know. I'd take Geo's point after. I'd take the kick. But timeout called, and the Bearcats come over to the sideline. It gives us a chance to tell you about Monday Night Sports Talk, live every Monday, 7 to 8, regional, national, local sports. We talk about it online at theairnetwork.net and 94.1 FM in Huntington. And, of course, the big question is, will Chad States be a part of the show this week?
And that's a great question. I have to look at my calendar and see, but I think there might be an appearance. I have to check some performing arts schedules that are sitting out there for me.
They're going to go for two.
Yep.
By the way, thanks to the anonymous Bearcat alumnus, also, Deb Kramer and ASCF of Sharpsburg, Georgia, and the Huntington Bearcat Football Booster Club for contributing to the PIAA broadcast fees for tonight's broadcast on the Air Network and 94.1 FM in Huntington. So the ball marked at the one-yard line, and the Bearcats are going to go for two. We're going to have Weglars and Border in the backfield with Andrew Hootie, and we got Jonathan Price once again wide to the right to the near sideline. It's going to be a keep. Hootie keeps driving. He's in for two.
Good play call that time by the Bearcats. As you're right, Dave, they lined Border up on the left side of Hootie. They lined Weglars up on the right side of Hootie. The snap came back to him, and those two just kind of angled right in for Andrew just to follow right behind their backs and make the push. And Andrew cleared that by 2 or 3 yards into the end zone. So good play call that time, and now Huntington takes an 8-6 lead.
8-6, 4:51 left to go in the first half, and suddenly things are coming up Bearcats. Once again, we need another good stop here by the defense. The defense warming to the task, and in particular, Jairus Warner with such a great defensive performance so far in the football game, because there's been a lot of the best plays for Forest Hills have been their passing plays, sure. And it's been Jairus Warner who's been providing the good coverage and defense. Bearcats taking their time, getting ready to go, and we can tell you that the Pitt Panthers will be heard over most of the same internet station and also on 94.1 FM tomorrow. Virginia, the competition, the Air Network has all the action. We'll be on about noon for the pregame show, followed by kickoff at 12:20, courtesy of the Pitt IMG Sports Network. So once again, be ready for that at noon tomorrow. I don't know. I haven't heard from Greg if we're going to have the Bearcat District 6 AAA Championship game replay right before that. That's what we've been doing throughout the regular season, but Greg is feverishly typing something to me right now. Take your time, Greg, because we're in a TV break here.
I do want to announce that one, that touchdown pass, Andrew Hootie became the single season passing, set the single season passing record with that throw. He only needed 26 yards coming in. That pass play was for 63. So, Andrew Hootie, congratulations to you, setting another record here this year for the Bearcats.
By the way, I'd like to point out that Teresa Hawbaker, director of the Huntington Community Center, is going to be discussing the programs available to area youth. That's coming up at halftime. And it's actually Virginia Tech, Greg Banks. And this game will be on at 9 tomorrow morning. The District 6 AAA Championship game will be replayed before the Pitt-Virginia Tech game. I thought it was Virginia Tech. And I should have known that there was a mistake there because, you know, Tech's the Hokies, and, of course, Virginia's the Cavaliers. I just kind of caught up in the moment of being here for a District 6 championship game.
Before he kicks off, I'll make the announcement, Dave. I don't know whether you know it or not, but Reese Ritchie, sophomore left-hander, now junior left-hander for the Bearcats, just committed to the University of Virginia.
How about that? Kickoff by Gio Scotchi, a beautiful end-over-end, fielded at the 8-yard line, out over the 10, 15, 20, 25, and then tripped up at the 25-yard line and dropped at about the 27 on the return. That was Seth Richardson, and Richardson brought down by the Bearcats. First and 10, Rangers ball at their own 27. So the big thing is, can the D come up with something good here?
Well, they've done it so far. They keep coming up and coming up and shutting down this Forest Hills offense right when they need to. You know, it's a bend-don't-break type of defense right now for the Bearcats as they come up with these big plays. But I still think Cesari is going to try to want to expose this outside, these fly patterns with Wolf Hope and with Long, and see if he can finally hook one up here.
4:44 left in the first half. Man in motion is Long. The pass comes over in his direction. What a great fingertip catch. And then the tackle was not made, but it was enough to send him out of bounds. Drew Weglars had his hand on the ankle of Long, and John Long went out of bounds at the 33. So it will be a gain of 6 and a second down and 4 now for Forest Hills. That's one of the big things, though. You really need to wrap up those tackles.
Well, we're seeing some good, interesting patterns. That way, you know, that time Long coming right out of the backfield and just coming right in front of the linebackers. And I had said early on that the safeties are really going to have to step up and play outstanding football game tonight. Finkel with an interception so far. We've seen Weglars come up and make some pretty big tackles and play. So
time out Forest Hills, by the way.
Yep, these safeties are going to be they're going to be asked a lot of tonight because of the way the backs run out of the backfield for Forest Hills in the pass catching sense.
We want to thank our Bearcat broadcast boosters. They've been with us all season and bringing you tonight's District 6 title game as well. The Huntington Moose Family Center, 223, D.C. Goodman & Sons, and the Goodman Family, All-American Pizza and Subs, Simone Chiropractic and Weight Loss, and Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing. They are the Bearcat broadcast boosters, and we thank them for supporting a great season of football on the Air Network and 94.1 FM. In Huntington. Bishop Guilfoyle, 42, Juniata Valley, zip. That game in the second quarter. That's all that needs to be said about that. And that could be a topic for discussion on Monday Night Sports Talk. We'll see. May come up.
If I'm there, it will come up. I'm calling it right now. Greg, let's just start with it.
Second down and 4. Forest Hills ball at their own 33. Bearcats lead the game by a score of 8-6. There's the snap. Back to Cesari. Lets it go down the right side and off the fingertips of the intended receiver, which was Long over on the right side.
And Huntington very fortunate on that as Jonathan Price slipped on that. He slipped on the coverage and Long was open. And fortunately, Cesari floated that ball just a little bit too far out of Long's reach, or that might have been a touchdown because, again, Price was unable to find his footing on that. He recovered, but not in time. So thank goodness that Cesari's pass floated a little bit far, and it'll set up third down here for the Rangers, 4:31 to go.
Long time in the huddle for the Rangers, figuring out what they're going to do on this play, and it is indeed a big third down. Passing completion, stopping the clock at 4:31. Snap to Cesari, quick pass to Long. He's got first down yardage and more over the 40, 45, 50 into Huntington territory for another Forest Hills first down. They mark him down at the 47-yard line of the Bearcats.
And
you can just see that play coming from here.
Yeah, and they've got to get somebody on him because he came out of the backfield and was standing there. There was nobody within 6 yards of him.
Nope, he was just absolutely, and it's amazing. Now, we're not down in the field. So, you know, we're not seeing things the way the players do on the field. And number 10 is a pretty shifty guy for the Forest Hills Rangers, and he's coming our way right now. And it's instead going to be the quarterback Cesari keeping. He'll pick up a couple before being run out of bounds by the Bearcats. I think that includes, was that Briggs over there, Briggs?
Yeah, well, it includes Miller, Briggs, and it looks like Andrew Houdian on that tackle. They brought him into the game to help to play safety, but... Huntington's got to solve that backfield problem with Long coming out of there. He's up to 6 catches and 80 yards. And again, I had said it in my pregame write-up that if Cesari and Long are going to play pitch and catch, the dam's going to break at some point here because of it, and Huntington's going to have to solve that quickly.
Well, my suggestion is to let Andrew Finkel just take Long the rest of the night. How about that?
Something's got to happen. You got to have somebody on that kid.
Here's the pass. It is complete to the 41-yard line. Wolf Hope eludes a tackler and is off down the sidelines and is eventually tripped up as he gets inside the 10 to the 9-yard line and a touchdown saving tackle by Price. So you got these two weapons, and really Forest Hills has not been changing this up much, Chad. I mean, it's the Long and Wolf Hope show.
Yeah, and they really don't have to. I mean, you know, they've missed some opportunities with those guys, and I think they realize that, and they just keep going back to the well and hoping that it just it keeps replenishing them, and it's going to here.
Down to 3 minutes left to go in the first half. You just don't want to give up these points, but I'll tell you what, here's Forest Hills knocking on the door, first and goal. And the handoff this time goes to Elgin. Elgin is met by a host of Bearcat tacklers and is eventually pushed back. I think that's going to be a no gain. Maybe he got a yard. I don't know. It looks like they gave him up to the 8.
But you want to talk about the strength of Elgin. He had the whole entire Bearcat defense on him, and he's still standing up at the end of that play. So that's good tough running there by the senior running back.
Gain of 1 and a second down and goal from the 8-yard line. Eric Elgin, 6'206", but he's obviously put some time in the weight room working on those legs.
This pass is going to Long. I'm going to play a Tony Romo here. I think it's going to Long.
Okay. 2:13 left to go in the first half. It's a handoff instead, and it gains yardage down to about the 6-yard line, as that's a keep by Adam Cesari, and Cesari picks up 2, and it's now 3rd and goal from the 6.
And that's why you don't mistake me for being Tony Romo. I made a completely wrong call there is what happens, but...
Quite all right.
Nonetheless, 2-yard pickup, and they're 2 yards closer here to pay dirt as Forest Hills. And again, this is a big 3rd down stop. I don't know how good Forest Hills' field goal kicker is. I would like to think that they're probably in 4-down territory here as well.
Minute 38 left to go in the first half. Bearcats don't want to give up these points. They lead it 8-6 at this point. It's going to be another keep, and Cesari's into the end zone for a touchdown, going off the right tackle. And in without really being, there was a little resistance right at the line of scrimmage, but he squirted right through that and right into the end zone. And it puts Forest Hills back in the lead. It is the Rangers 12 and the Bearcats 8. And you would suspect, of course, that the Rangers would be going for 2 as their first point after attempt failed. And they want to get back into that positive area. So they'll go for 2 here. Now, this would be big if the Bearcats could shut this down. Let's see what happens. Wolf Hope is on Jairus Warner. It's going to be a keep by Cesari. He's going to, oh my, phew, I thought he was going to get away there. The Bearcats had him stymied at about the 3-yard line, and then he just kept going. I thought he was going to get loose and get in, but he didn't. And that's some good work there by the Bearcats special teams, taking care of keeping the Rangers out of the end zone for the 2-point conversion. So the score remains Forest Hills 12 and the Bearcats 8, and you can take a little moral victory away from that. Now here's the situation, a minute 28 left to go. One of the things that I've been complimentary about with this football team is their ability to utilize some great clock management skills at the end of the first half and come up with points, and we can only hope that something is in the playbook to make that happen again.
Well, we're going to need that, but I also think Huntington's going to need a decent return here out of Wagner or Price. It'll be interesting to see if they kick deep to them. They have all game long so far. Price averaging about 27 yards per return here out of the two returns that he has. I really think that they're going to try and pop this one up because you don't want to continue to kick deep to one of these two returners, that being Jacob Wagner and Jonathan Price, because eventually you're going to get burned. It's going to happen. So Forest Hills, it'll be interesting to see what they do with this football here.
I want to say thanks to Dustin Eberhardt for checking in and listening to the Air Network. Peg Bennett's tuned in to 94.1 FM in Huntington. And once again, thanks. Nathaniel Eberhardt also checking in. Short kick is picked up at the 18-yard line by Price. No, I'm sorry, that's by Wagner. Wagner gets out over the 40 to about the 43. You ask for a good return, your team delivered.
Oh, that's the difference. I mean, there's a 26-yard return by Wagner, and it's the special teams that can make all the difference in the football game. And if Forest Hills continues, hopefully they don't kick off too many more times on Huntington. But if they continue to do that, I think they're going to get burned at some point in time. And you can see special teams is hurting Forest Hills right now. Is the extra points not being on the board hurts, and them giving up the penalty on an extra point to allow Huntington to have another shot is hurting them too, because it's only a 4-point game.
Minute 19 left to go. Andrew Hootie in the shotgun as usual. Back to pass, looks over here near side. Jonathan Price, pass complete over midfield and ripped out of bounds at the 49-yard line, although the official signaled that the clock was going to continue to roll, and that immediately brings a timeout from Coach Hootie and the Bearcat bench. Taken out of bounds by John Long. John Long showing his skill as a defender there. 6 foot, a buck 80, and he wrapped up Jonathan Price, who's 5'8", a buck 45, and that was a WWE kind of takedown.
Yeah, exactly right. In fact, I just watched that a Ric Flair special on ESPN. If you get a chance, catch that, Dave. It's actually
is that really, a 30 for 30?
Really good. A really good 30 for 30.
I will catch that. Yes. I'm a big fan of the Nature Boy.
Yes, well, it was...
just stealing, wheeling, dealing. It's limousine riding, jet flying, son of a gun.
It's wonderful. It's really, really, it's one of the better 30 for 30s that they've done.
Catholics and Convicts was good, too.
Yeah, we watched that a couple times, too. That might be part of the topic of conversation on Monday Night Sports Talk as well, with JV, Juniata Valley, losing here to Bishop Guilfoyle.
Greg Banks chimes in and says the Ric Flair documentary was heart-wrenching.
Yes. Well, yeah, it was. There was a lot of emotion in that one.
Yeah. Delaware Valley, by the way, 7-0 over the State College Little Lions. That is in the second quarter. Here, it's Forest Hills 12 and Huntington 8. First, make that second down and a couple. Andrew Hootie in trouble, bounces off the would-be tackler, but then Luke Williams of Forest Hills circles right back and takes Andrew Hootie down for a big loss back beyond 1 yard beyond the original line of scrimmage, which was the 43, and a timeout taken by the Bearcats as they are now facing a third and 11 after that play failed.
It's a third sack on Hootie tonight by Forest Hills.
It's unusual.
It just seems like they're getting one guy free every single time to come in that disrupts this Bearcat offense. And Huntington's going to have to find something to change that here in the second half. Now, Huntington's going to be kicking off the Forest Hills. So Huntington's going to have to come out and get a stop, as far as I'm concerned, right off of the bat. But they're going to have to find something to get some of these playmakers going. Border 6 carries for 6 yards so far on the evening. Andrew Hootie is 4 of 10 for 90 yards. Two of those catches coming up by Price. He has 2 catches for 71 yards and a touchdown. But again, it's just been a piecemeal offense so far through this first half, with Huntington having no rhythm whatsoever. And they're going to have to try to find something in the second half if they want to continue their season.
Third down and 11, 58 seconds left to go, and the Bearcats aren't exactly burning the time off the clock. You never know what Forest Hills might be able to do. Here's a pass complete to Ben Briggs. He has the first down and more as he's over the 40-yard line to about the 38 of Forest Hills. And without any timeouts, the Bearcats have to rush up to the line. The official sets the ball. The chains are moving. The clock has stopped. 51 seconds left to go. Sticks are planted, and the Bearcats are set and ready to roll. Hootie rolling to his left. Fires one. Jonathan Price catches it and quickly out of bounds at the 25-yard line. And another Bearcat first down.
Well, we talked about rhythm, and there's some rhythm going on right now. 13-yard pass play that time for Price, from Hootie to Price, and a big catch that time by the tight end, Ben Briggs, and kind of a redemption catch. We saw Ben drop a few passes last game against Juniata, and that was a huge first down for the Bearcats, a huge third down conversion for them.
43 seconds left to go in the first half. Never mind Forest Hills. It's the Bearcats on a roll here, and the chains are tangled up on the far side. They got a problem. I think the chains actually may have come apart on the far sideline, and that'll give us a chance to remind you that coming up at halftime, it's Teresa Hobaker, director of the Huntington Community Center, that is. She'll be discussing the programs available to area youth. Coming up tomorrow, it is Virginia Tech, the Hokies, and the Pitt Panthers. Your network has you covered. It is the pregame show at noon, followed by kickoff at 12:20 on the Pitt IMG Sports Network here on the Air Network. And 94.1 FM in Huntington, and preceding that game, it will be a replay of tonight's District 6 AAA Championship game.
Dave, you talked about good clock management. We're seeing it right now out of the Huntington offense. 43 seconds left to go at the 25.
12-8, Forest Hills with the lead. Snap to Hootie. Looks toward the sideline, and the pass was intended for Border. Border pulled one of those where he did not line up in the typical tailback position beside Hootie. He went down to the left side and started down the sideline. So for me, that was kind of telegraphed that that was who he was going to be going to. But Andrew Hootie's, I think, a little too used throwing
the
Price.
But he had to rush the football that time. Andrew can't take a sack in this situation if you want to try to get Gio Von Scotch out here for a field goal attempt. He had the defensive ends crashing in on him on the pocket, so he had to make that throw. And a little bit strong to get that away, because he cannot afford to take a sack here if Huntington wants to score.
Pass falls incomplete, a second down and 10, 37 seconds left. Hootie back to pass, looks downfield to the right side, lets it go for Price, and nice effort by Price to keep the interception by John Long from happening, because Long has been assigned Jonathan Price. As far as a defensive assignment, Long, of course, the big receiver for Ciceri, and in this case, that ended up being a jump ball once again because of the athleticism of Jonathan Price.
Right, and I was gonna point to that. You know, when you play multiple sports, sometimes those other sports come into play in the one you're playing in now. Jonathan's a great basketball player, and you can see that. That's basketball skills that come back to help you in a situation like that.
Looking forward to talking or being around the boys basketball program. Here's a pass that's intercepted by Long at the 10. Intended for Price. Long is back over the 20. Still going, and gets out over the 25 to almost the 26. We'll see where they mark him down. And he does all that, makes the interception, and gets up to there. And still 17 seconds left on the clock for the Rangers. So we'll see what may transpire here. A couple of notes from Greg Banks. Forest Hills coach Don Bailey with the Rangers over 40 years, and his son Brandon Bailey with Richmond High for over 15 now. And let's see what else Greg has to say. The Hooties, Sellers, and Mikett coaching staff now over two generations with the Bearcats. And then, of course, you have the Suns playing, which makes it three generations of Bearcats. And Coach Bailey and the Forest Hills Rangers decide that they're going to be satisfied to walk in at halftime with a four-point lead. As they take the snap, don't do anything, and the clock runs down to zeros. We have one half in the books in the District 6 AAA Championship game. And the score, the Forest Hills Rangers 12 and the Huntington Bearcats 8. Chad States will be feverishly working on the statistics from the first half. We'll come back with that and much more as halftime begins here on the airnetwork.net. Stay tuned, because we have a great halftime interview coming up with Greg Banks. So that is all part of our halftime. By the way, since basketball did come up, you will be hearing Bearcat boys and girls basketball coming up in January. And, of course, Chad's favorite, Bearcat Wrestling.
Yeah.
All right. Teresa Hawbaker, director of the Huntington Community Center, talking about the programs available to area youth. Coming up next, it's halftime with the score, Forest Hills 12 and the Bearcats 8. More after this on theairnetwork.net and 94.1 FM in Huntington. D.C. Goodman & Sons and the Goodman family are committed and dedicated to excellence by supporting quality education and athletics for all youth of Huntington County. For over three generations, D.C. Goodman & Sons and their staff of quality tradesmen have provided excellent service in the installation of plumbing, mechanical and industrial piping, electrical, and fire sprinkler systems. Residential services are also available. D.C. Goodman & Sons and the Goodman family will continue to serve the community and thank you for your support. The Goodman family wishes you the best to all area students in your pursuit of excellence. All-American Pizza and Subs in downtown Huntington offers up the family meal deal with a large one-topping pizza, a dozen wings, and a 2-liter Pepsi product for only $21.99. All-American also presents Double Punch Month, where you can save big on a large sub or lunch special during the month of November. Stop by All-American Pizza and Subs at 612 Washington Street in downtown Huntington, home of the Bearcat Sub. Call 643-0222 for deliveries, open until 9 p.m., closed Monday.
The Huntington Moose Family Center 223 is the heart of the community with loads of activities year-round. The Huntington Moose Family Center 223 proudly sponsors social events for members and their guests. Plus, you can enjoy their Friday food specials starting at 5 p.m. every Friday. Check out an entertaining evening with the band Swamp Root Saturday, November 25th from 8 to 11 p.m. Check out our website for other exciting events coming up at the Huntington Moose Family Center 223, the heart of the community. Join us today.
Hi, I'm Drew Weglard, and you're listening to the Huntington Bearcats on airnetwork.net.
It's halftime of the Huntington Forest Hills Tilt at Mention Park live on theairnetwork.net and 94.1 FM. It's Greg Banks at halftime, Dave Shannon and Chad State standing by at Mention Park with second half coming up in just a mere moment or two. Meanwhile, revisiting something we talked about earlier this season with Teresa Hawbaker, who is at the Huntington Community Center, detailing a little bit about what the community center does. And again, we honored Ted Arndt, who has been the director for over 50 years at the Huntington Community Center, and all begins with the youth programs all the way up to high school. So Teresa had a chance to sit down with us, tell us a little bit about the community center and all the great things going on. And of course, you can be a part of it.
Well, the history of the center, the Lions Club had offered the building to the community center many years ago. Mm-hmm. And so the community center has been running it ever since. And we have many programs that we offer children, all age groups from pre-K the whole way up to 12th grade. We're currently working with kids in the pre-K to third grade with an indoor soccer program that we have. And we're doing track and field registrations, and that covers third grade through, I believe, ninth grade.
Okay.
So there's a lot here to offer all the kids in the community, and they take anybody from all around Mount Union, Juniata Valley, anywhere in Huntington.
So it really is almost a county thing now, whereas before, I think when I was in school in the 60s and 70s, it was primarily for Huntington kids?
Yes, I believe so. That's how I understand it.
Okay.
We don't turn away any kids, because that's what this is all about. The community center is about the kids, and our executive director, Ted Arndt, makes sure that all kids get to participate, and that's our philosophy.
Told Ted recently, as I saw him, that he was sort of like the surrogate father in Huntington because he raised a lot of kids at the Huntington Community Center. Let's talk first of all about the specific location of the original center. And you say that building was donated by the Lions probably back in the 30s or 40s, I'm thinking.
Yes.
Okay. Now, having said that, Ted hasn't been here that long, folks, but he's been here a long time because I'm 62 and he was here when I was a kid. Now, having said that, back in those days, we had community dances for the kids. We had roller skating. We had, of course, the bitty basketball leagues, the senior leagues. I guess some of that stuff still continues to this day, correct?
Yes, that is true.
Okay.
Now, we don't do the dances anymore, but we have roller skating on Friday nights in, from November to April. So we're wrapping up this season of roller skating. And, you know, we're trying to get more programs in place to offer. We have the William Smith Building as well.
Right.
That we'd like to open up for use to the public as well.
Now, you have a gymnasium there because they knocked down the actual school, but it left the cafeteria, I believe.
They did. They turned that into a gymnasium. It's a really nice facility for that. And they just recently fixed up the kitchen area so that they can hopefully open it up for to have community meals.
And but you have other locations outside, which to my surprise would be Detweiler Park as well, right?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, now what kind of programs you have there?
We hold our t-ball programs, softball, and our...
Is there a soccer program? I think
we do have a soccer program in the fall.
Okay.
Now this spring we'll have, you know, the t-ball will be run there. We did have a softball. I misspoke. There was a softball program for the younger kids for third through fifth grade.
Right.
But we don't have that program anymore.
Yeah. Now they have the Little League that just started here recently.
Yeah, they just opened that up. So, so we don't offer that anymore. But we do have the t-ball program.
Now, how about because of that beautiful track out there? Would you have track and field at all out there, Detweiler, or where is that held?
The track and field is held at Juniata College.
Oh, okay.
So they let us use the facility and graciously.
Yes.
And they practice there a couple days a week, and the track and field usually has about four meets a year.
Okay. Just for the sake of the listeners who are tuning in from outside of Huntington, not familiar with the Huntington Community Center, Ted Arndt is the executive director. There is also a board of people in the community that actually operate the centers, you know, from a financial standpoint or making some kind of plans, that type of thing?
Yes, we have a board of about 19 people, and they sit on various committees, and they make sure that the center runs smoothly.
Okay.
You know, to help Ted out, because Ted really runs the center.
Yeah. Yeah. He's the executive director now. He also is the chief bar watcher oftentimes, but he's allowed people to do their jobs.
Yes, he does. Okay. He's very supportive of all of us, and but yes, we have a board who takes care of the financial end of things.
Okay.
and comes up with some new ideas for programming and and fundraising, that type of thing.
Speaking of which, fundraising, all these years, the community center basically operated through the assistance of the community, correct? I mean, there's not a lot of government money, if any, to my understanding, that's involved in running the center?
No, we do have a program that we run in the summer. It's the summer lunch program.
Okay.
And now that is a federally funded program.
Mm-hmm.
But for the most part, we are run by donations from the community.
All right. All right. Let's talk a little bit about those other outside projects like the summer food program. Now, when does that happen, and what's the eligibility, you think, for somebody to get fed? Where do they get fed?
Well, the summer food program is open here, and it's for children ages 2 to 18.
Okay.
Now, we do offer it to other folks, you know, to people older than 18,
mm-hmm.
but they have a minimal fee that they would have to pay.
Right.
And that's usually run here at the center in the summer, and it starts in June.
In the center, if I'm not mistaken, we're right off of Washington Street. What is this street
we're
here?
We're on Fifth Street.
Fifth Street.
Yes, okay. 310 Fifth Street.
310 Fifth Street.
Yes.
Okay, so the food program runs primarily in the summer when the schools are shut down. There is a minimal fee for those people that are over 18. Are there fees for any of the other recreational things, Teresa? Because really, I guess other than registration, there really isn't. It's pretty much free, right?
Pretty much. For we have registration fees because we do have, you know, cost incurred with all that. Our gymnastics program has a monthly fee because they, you know, it's a little more involved than our other programs. But yes, for the most part, it is a minimal fee that we charge for per student.
Okay. I don't want to jump around here, but I remember that we didn't have gymnastics back in my day. Do you have a swimming program too, where these people travel?
We do have a swimming program, and that's, we have a winter program and we have a summer program. The summer program will be starting. They have registrations in May. And I don't have specific dates for when they have run their season.
Right.
But yes, they do. They do travel and they have a nice program.
Keeping in mind that once we do let you know about registrations, because we can do that on our website at theairnetwork.net, we list those programs and, of course, registration dates and information. But what number can they generally call if the public wants to get, let's say, more information regarding any of these programs?
They can always check out our website at huntcommunitycenter.org. They can also call the center. There's usually somebody here, and if not, they can leave a message. It's at 643-4241. And you can also email me at huntingtoncommunitycenter@gmail.com.
Fantastic. Speaking of which, there's an educational component to the community center as well, where you've kind of integrated and created synergies with maybe the college or some other people?
Yes, we work with Juniata College. We have students come in and run the program, the after-school program.
Okay.
And that runs according to Juniata College's schedule. So, and the kids come in from 4 to 6, Monday through Thursday, you know, during the Juniata College school day, or school year. And, you know, and they work with the kids on educational components, and then they also integrate some, you know, a little bit of fun too.
Oh, yeah. That's always fantastic. Now, there's always a need for more money. Let's say somebody wants to donate money for equipment. We probably could use more computers, maybe more, you know. How do we go about making donations?
You can always send, you know, to the center directly if you would like to do that. You know, we did just get a nice grant for the education center upstairs with mutual benefit. There's always, you know, there's grants. Sometimes we get matching grants, but you can always contact the center for more information on that.
Right.
But if you just want to make a general donation, you can send it to our mail address.
Right.
And it's listed on our website.
Okay. And the website again is?
huntcommunitycenter.org.
Okay.
Again, we want to thank Teresa Hallbaker, the director of the Huntington Community Center, for sharing some things with us, of course, at a previous date. And we just want to say that if you have a child in the Huntington County region who might need some instruction academically, maybe looking for a fun place to spend some time, roller skating, they have swim programs, gymnastics, you name it, they have it. And they've been going on for years because of your donations. All you have to do is go to that huntcommunitycenter.org. Check out more information on the Huntington Community Center. Again, thank you to Teresa Hallbaker and the executive director for many years, 50 years now, the best to Ted Arndt, our good friend. And that's from all of us here at theairnetwork.net and 94.1 FM. Hey, it's halftime of the Huntington Forest Hills Tilt. District 6 Championship is on the line tonight, live from Mansion Park. Dave Shannon and Chad States has second half action, all coming up next on theairnetwork.net and 94.1 FM in Huntington.
Call Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing for affordable heating, plumbing, and drain cleaning services in Huntington. Count on 12 years of insured excellent service when it comes to heating, plumbing, ventilation, and drain cleaning. Call Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing, available evenings and weekends at an affordable rate. Call 814-506-5128. That's 506-5128 for Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing in Huntington.
Sometimes facts are hard to face. Statistics show that obesity is a problem in the United States, and it's not getting any better. At Simone Family Chiropractic, we understand this problem. We also know that obesity leads to very serious health problems later in life. There is a way to cleanse your body and get back to optimum health. It is called the doctor-supervised ChiroThin system, and it teaches you how and what to eat in the real world. Call us at Simone Family Chiropractic at 814-643-2616 or stop in and see us at 613 Washington Street in Huntington across from All American Pizza or find us on Facebook.
The Huntington Moose Family Center 223 is the heart of the community with loads of activities year-round. The Huntington Moose Family Center 223 proudly sponsors social events for members and their guests. Plus, you can enjoy their Friday food specials starting at 5 p.m. every Friday. Check out an entertaining evening with the band Swamp Root Saturday, November 25th from 8 to 11 p.m. Check out our website for other exciting events coming up at the Huntington Moose Family Center 223, the heart of the community. Join us today.
Hi, this is Andrew Hootie. You're listening to the Huntington Bearcats on the airnetwork.net.
And we welcome Jairus you Warner. Back.
I'm listening to the Bearcats on the airnetwork.net.
That's good, Jairus, because right now you are the almost at the point where you call you an MVP of this particular game here tonight. Jairus Warner with a heck of a first half defensively. Really, the Rangers could have had much more than 12, but he has been such an effective defender out there.
Right. And Huntington had their opportunities, too. They dropped the touchdown pass in the end zone down here and then followed that up with a missed field goal. So this game could be a little bit tighter than what it is. Mm-hmm. But with that said, it's a 12-8 lead for Forest Hills. Forest Hills will receive the second half kickoff. As we look down some first half stats, Huntington with five first downs, Forest Hills with eight, Huntington with only 5 net yards rushing, Dave. And like you said at the beginning of the broadcast here, that has to change. They've got to get something going on the ground. Forest Hills with 54, Huntington with 123 yards passing, Forest Hills with 139. So 128 yards of offense for the Bearcats to 193 for the Rangers. Neither team with a fumble in the game. Penalties have been pretty much non-existent here. The only one really that mattered that doesn't go on the score sheet is the one that happened down here on the extra point on a point after attempt. But Huntington with one penalty for 5 yards, Forest Hills 2 for 15. Huntington throwing 2 interceptions in that first half, and Forest Hills throwing 1. Individually for the Bearcats, Border 6 carries for 6 yards. Weglar's 2 carries for 6 yards. And Andrew Hootie 6 carries for minus 7, but he's also been sacked 3 times in the first half. If we look over at the Forest Hills side, Eric Elgin, 6 carries for 27 yards. He's the leading ground gainer for the Rangers. And Adam Cesari, 7 rushes for 26 yards and 1 touchdown. Passing, Andrew Hootie is 6 of 15 for 123 yards, 1 touchdown and 2 interceptions. Adam Cesari, 8 of 18, 193 yards and 1 interception. Both of them, they have their favorite targets coming in, and that's exactly who it is on the score sheet. Jonathan Price, 3 catches, 84 yards, 1 touchdown, that coming on that 63-yard, what I call Miracle of Mansion Park catch that he had here in the middle of the field. Jairus Warner, 1 catch for 19. Ben Briggs, 1 catch for 20, and an all-important catch to keep it drive the line. It was a great catch for him. And then Jacob Wagner, 1 catch and no yards on that. For Forest Hills, it's the familiar faces of Jonathan Long, 6 catches for 80 yards. Wolf Hope, 1 catch for 37, and then Shope, 1 for 22. Really, Dave, if you look at it, both teams with some missed opportunities in that first half. This game is it's still anybody's ball game, but if I had to give, to score the round, I would say that Forest Hills won the first half.
By the way, I wanted to say hello to Steve Pooge Hoffman, listening in South Carolina. Kathy Berkey Milner is listening in Altoona. They're from the class of 72. So thanks to those Bearcat alums for tuning in tonight, Pooge Hoffman and Kathy Berkey Milner. Set the kickoff. Gio Scotcha has it teed up at the 40-yard line. Approaches the football, kicks it away. Over to Ward Long. Hits at the 8. Long fields it at about the 5. Out over the 10, the 15, cutting toward the near side. Still going 20. And then a stiff arm at the 25, and he's loose. Down over the 40, 45, and is tripped up at midfield in a touchdown, saving tackle by Derek Foltz. Foltz gets in there. Nice special teams trip up by Foltz to stop that one. Otherwise, Long might have been gone.
You just saw his elusiveness there, Dave, as far as...
Congratulations, Frank Germany. Tyrone wins the 50-50. Frank Germany.
Go ahead,
Jay. Okay, yeah, we just saw his elusiveness on that 45-yard run as he was able to evade a bevy of Bearcat tacklers and get this out to midfield.
First and 10, Rangers football, and the handoff goes to Elgin. Elgin's over the 40, breaking tackles, knocking down Jacob Wagner, and eventually getting down to the 23-yard line, where he's tripped up by Alex Mikett and finally stopped. But what a big gain on the first play from scrimmage in the second half for Forest Hills.
Well, and he's just doubled up his rushing totals with that one carry, but that's something that Huntington just did not need to have happen right out of the gates, is a 27-yard run by the fullback for Forest Hills to set them up in great field position.
Rangers up by a score of 12-8. They get the ball first here in the second half, and they're on a roll. Hand off to Elgin again. Tries to wait for some blocking to take place, but it never does. And the Bearcats collapse around him as Owen Kaufman comes in to make the stop on Elgin along with some of his friends.
And that's more like it for Huntington to be able to stifle the middle of that defense. We haven't seen very many big gainers up the gut against Huntington. That's one of the few this season. So that time Huntington was ready for the run, able to stop it and set up a second long for the Forest Hills Rangers.
By the way, I was going to say, have you noticed the eerie similarity between this game for the Bearcats and the Central game?
Yeah, it's yes, all too much.
Third down and 9, and it is Cesari escaping. That almost looked like a broken play. It was a run-pass option, and eventually Cesari held on to the ball, and Adam was brought down, but it was a very awkward-looking play in execution.
And Cesari looked confused on that run, too. He wasn't looking downfield, and I didn't see any receivers really running wild down there either. No. So I think you're right. I think it was probably more in the lines of a broken play.
Sets up a third down and 6. Bearcat defense being called upon again to stop this potent offense of the Forest Hills Rangers. In the shotgun, it's Adam Cesari. Takes the snap, steps back, is chased out of the pocket by Border, and then escapes. Ben Briggs is going to try to run him down, and eventually he's taken out of bounds on the far side by Andrew Miller.
Yeah.
Yeah, Miller takes him out of bounds, but not before. I do believe he has first down yardage. Nope, it's fourth down. He's just shy of the sticks by less than a yard. How many less than a yards have we seen here tonight? We have another one in front of us right now. They do mark him out of bounds, and a flag comes in.
And this will be an interesting call.
Yes, it will.
Because if it's against...
Sideline violation.
Wow.
Sideline violation on Forest Hills. The flag comes in, and with fourth down and less than a yard to go...
Well, he's just calling it a warning, so he just dropped the flag. Okay. So that's the first time we've seen that call, so it is a warning. Had that been a penalty, it would have been huge, but that was just a warning.
All right, I would venture a guess this is going to be Cesari on a keep, but I could be wrong. He is up under center.
Oh, it's 6'3", 215 pounds, and they're going to call timeout.
And he calls timeout.
Wow. Seeing something they don't like.
What would you see when you can basically fall forward?
I would agree. I don't know. I don't know. When you're that big of and that good of an athlete, and you're right, when you can fall forward for the first down, I don't know why you burn a timeout.
Well, it's been done. Maybe that'll come into play in the Bearcats' favor later. By the way, thanks to the anonymous Bearcat alums for participating and supporting us in tonight's broadcast, along with Deb Kramer, an ASCF of Sharpsburg, Georgia, and the Huntington Bearcat Football Booster Club. They contributed tonight as well for the PIAA broadcast fees for tonight's broadcast on the Air Network and 94.1 FM in Huntington. Thank you, one and all. Hey, I have one of those little green tags as the water personnel make it out onto the field for the Bearcats.
Chad and I both had one of those. Lots of little green tags.
Even Coach Hootie had to wear one, so I guess that makes it official. 9:57 left to go in the third quarter, and instead it's going to be a handoff. Was that the long?
I think so. Dive play for long. He's able to go ahead and scoot through for probably 2 yards on the carry. I'm surprised it wasn't a quarterback sneak.
Well, you kind of tip your hand to a degree, when he comes up under center there and then calls the timeout. So you go off to something else, and it was easily successful as he gains the yards needed to make it a first down and 10. They're at the 12-yard line, so they can get a first without scoring. Clock rolling, 9:39, 12-8 Forest Hills with the lead, and that was a bit of an awkward approach to the line of scrimmage on the handoff to Elgin that time.
Cesari late getting that handoff into his belly.
He kind of tripped over.
Yeah, it does.
over Ciceri there as he was approaching the line. So
pick up 1 yard. Elgin now 9 carries, 56 yards on the evening. Leading ground gainer for everybody tonight.
And I guess there's a little bit of, if you want to, I hate this phrase, that bend don't break phrase, but it seems to be somewhat applicable to the Bearcats tonight. Snap to Ciceri. Steps, throws, complete to Wolford. And Wolf Hope gets into the end zone for a touchdown. He's been so close how many times tonight, and now he's able to get it into the end zone and score and put the Rangers up by a score of 18-8. Now, what will this team do? Will they go for a one-point after attempt? I think they are going to do, yes, the kicker is out there as Josh Jones makes his way out and hands tee off to Evan Coonrod. So Coonrod will hold, and once again it will be Josh Jones with a point after attempt. There's the spot, the kick is up, and that's much better than the previous attempt. That's right down the middle, and it's good, and it makes the score. Forest Hills 19 and the Bearcats 8. So the opening possession of the second half goes very well for the Forest Hills Rangers as they eventually get it into the end zone for a touchdown. And but we saw just about every offensive weapon they have in their arsenal on that drive.
Right, and I think we've seen just about every offensive weapon. So, you know, it doesn't look like they're going to burn Huntington with the big play. They're going to be a little bit more methodical going down here because the Huntington defense is playing a really good football game. This game now falls upon the shoulders of the Huntington offense, and can they do something? Last week, they had a record-breaking week against Juniata, but we had seen them do that against that same team last year, or previously in previous weeks. But they've got to break out against some of these better teams with better defenses. They weren't able to do it against Central. And so far tonight, they've really been stuck in the mud here, in one of those lower gears and not able to do much at all.
Bearcats just 2 possessions, 2 scores away from tying this particular football game up. That's the beauty of keeping those extra points from being converted 2 times. For the Forest Hills Rangers, the Bearcats can score a touchdown and kick a field goal and tie this thing up. First things first, let's get a good offensive drive going here in the second half. So this will be the first time that the Bearcats get to see the football after halftime on the offensive side of things.
And this game is definitely different than the one that was played last year. The one played last year at War Vets Field, you really got the sense, even you know, all the way through 3 quarters before Huntington really busted out in the 4th quarter, that Huntington was totally in control of that because they were dominating Forest Hills at the line of scrimmage. Tonight, Dave, that's not happening. Forest Hills has grown over the year, and you can see it as they've gotten stronger. Their skill position guys have become a lot better. Ciceri is a lot more decisive on what he's doing. Of course, that happens when you become a junior away from a sophomore. So a much different football team this year than what Huntington faced last year.
Josh Jones with a kickoff, a little short one that's fielded at the 35-yard line. And then a fumble on the return. And it's recovered by Forest Hills. Fielded by Ian Border. Border started across the middle of the field. And the football was tackled that time, and it popped out for Ian Border. And something that's a little bit of a surprise for us fans of Ian Border and these Bearcats. A couple of fumbles now, the last 2 weeks, this week and last week.
Yeah, well, Forest Hills got exactly what they wanted out of that. They wanted to keep it away from the 2 dangerous men back, and they kicked at the Border running east to west, and Forest Hills defender able to come up and jar that football loose, and Forest Hills back in business again here and can really strike a blow big time if they're able to score now, Dave.
Seriously threatening to be big time in the driver's seat up under center this time as Ciceri, and he hands the ball off. It's Long who gets down over the 25 and is brought down at about the 23-yard line. In on the tackle, Alex Mikan and Ian Border. But the gain is good for another Forest Hills Rangers first down. And they really seem to be taking control of this game now.
Yeah, you're starting to see it, the engine rev up. You're starting to see the confidence flow through Forest Hills. You're starting to see Huntington maybe get a little bit deflated because that's another big run right up the middle against this vaunted Bearcat defense. It hasn't allowed many of those this year.
19-8, Forest Hills with the lead and deep in Bearcat territory at the 23. hand off the long. He's swallowed up there as he tried the left side of the line and really got about a yard, maybe two. And we're going to say it's a gain of two and a second down and eight for Forest Hills.
This is unfamiliar territory for Huntington this season.
Certainly is.
Even in the central game, it was closer. It was, you know, it was, you were constantly within one score, and you never really felt that Central was really imposing its will. You're starting to get the feeling that Forest Hills is starting to impose its will against Huntington right now.
Here's Siri rolling to his right, looking back the other way, throwing toward the goal line, caught, touchdown, Seth Richardson with a catch all by himself. Darius Warner tried to get over there and provide some defense, but could you be much more wide open than what Richardson was?
No, he was wide open, completely wide open. And, you know, again, we're starting to find out that Forest Hills has a lot of weapons on offense, and Huntington's just not able to keep to take care of them.
25-8, Rangers with the lead now. 7:31 left to go in the third quarter. And as Chad said, unfamiliar territory for the Bearcats. Point after attempt is no good. That's wide to the right. So another bit of a problem. I guess if you could pick one thing out about Forest Hills, and I'm not meaning to pick on Josh Jones, the kicker, but unfortunately, that's been the only, you know, dim spot as far as it comes to Forest Hills in describing this football team and what they can do.
Yeah, that's still, yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's been a bugaboo. And eventually stuff like that comes back to bite you as you play, you know, some of the better schools. But tonight so far with Huntington only able to get 8 points on the board, it's really becoming, the longer this game goes on, a non-factor in this. But Huntington really has to get something going here, Dave. This is almost a must-score situation that they find themselves in at this point.
Bearcats need to put a good drive together and then start to root for a turnover from their defense that they can turn into points. Step A, let's have a good drive here. Down by 17 now, 25-8 with 7:31 left to go in the third quarter. Josh Jones with the kickoff. This time he kicks it away. It'll be fielded by Price at the 16-yard line. Over the 20, 25-30. Turns toward the near side, now over the 40, 45, and knocked out of bounds. Some good pursuit that time by Blaine Smay of Forest Hills, and he knocked him out of bounds, but not before. That's a handy return. And there is a flag, however, on the return, and that's never a good sign. Normally, those are blocks in the back.
No, and I'm surprised they're kicking it deep again, because that's really one of Huntington's better shots being able to put points on the board is between those two back there as kick returners. So I'm shocked that Forest Hills decided to do that.
Flag dropped at the 40. Here comes the white hat with the explanation. And it's holding against the Bearcats. So that was a bugaboo kind of penalty last week for the Bearcats.
It's only their second penalty. But only two penalties for each team, Dave.
No, they really cleaned that part of the game up. That was one thing that you could have picked on in the victory against Juniata that you thought may have been a weak spot for the Bearcats, but they have obviously addressed that and done well at it. First and 10 Bearcat football at their own 30. They need to get a score on this possession being down 17. Hootie in the shotgun, and to his left, it's Ian Border. Border switches to the right side. Ben Briggs goes over to the left side. Snap and the handoff to Border, who tries that left side, and he gets back to the line of scrimmage, and that's it.
Again, there's no room there, Dave.
Yeah, they're trying to spread that defense out, but good pursuit by the Forest Hills Rangers, and no holes for Ian Border to dart through to gain any kind of yardage. Second down and 10 with the ball at the 30.
Seven carries, 6 yards for Border right now, Dave. So really, really struggling up front is the Bearcats and trying to get this ground game going.
Second down and 10, clock rolling, 6:44 left to go, third quarter. And this is a handoff to Was that Border?
Yeah, it was Border. They lined up in Wildcat. But Wagler's with the run, but Border lined up in that Wildcat as Andrew Hootie became a split end in that formation.
Drew Wagler's with a nice gain as he gets out to almost the 39-yard line. We're going to call it third down and two. It is close, but we're going to make it third and two. It's actually kind of a long one if you want to look at it that way. But those statisticians, here we go, Wildcat again with Border. And he hands it off to Weglars again. First down and more over the 45, 50, 40, 30. He's going to get caught. And what an effort by Adam Ciceri coming up from behind. Weglars is no slouch when it comes to running. But I'll tell you what, to the credit of Adam Ciceri, he came up from behind. He almost tried a strip tackle. Well, he did try the strip tackle. And to Weglar's credit, he did not cough up the football. He gets down to the 8-yard line of Forest Hills. And just what the Bearcats needed to be a quick strike right here. And then they're going to need a turnover. So step A of our plan is going along okay so far.
Right.
And since the Wildcats working so well, the Bearcats stick with it. Except back there with him this time is Andrew Finkel. And I'm talking about Ian Border, and the handoff goes to Finkel. He tries that right side, but he's met there and slammed back to the ground by Jensen Bowen of Forest Hills. It'll be a no gainer, and it'll bring up a second down and goal.
But, Dave, it's what we had talked about. Huntington has to start showing different wrinkles, getting the ball in the hands of different people that Forest Hills isn't accustomed to accounting for at that point in time. They're not sure what to do with Weglars, and you can see that. Drew,
once
four
again,
carries, 68 yards.
Once again, back to the Central game.
Yes,
this
exactly.
is when we started to see this for the Bearcats.
Yep.
And now, confusion out there in the field. The Bearcats call timeout, and Ian Border seems to be the most frustrated of the Bearcats heading over to the sideline about what the heck's going on. What are we calling here? Because you had him, Hootie, and Weglars all in the backfield. By the way, tomorrow at 12 noon, it's going to be Pitt Panther football as the Panthers take on the Virginia Tech Hokies. The Air Network has the action at noon pregame, then the kickoff at 12:20. And it comes your way courtesy of the Pitt IMG Sports Network here on the Air Network and 94.1 FM Huntingdon. So the Bearcats trying to get these points, and hopefully they're able to do that. It's second down and goal, and they call the full timeout. By the way, I want to thank the Bearcat broadcast boosters once again. They are bringing you tonight's District 6 AAA title game, thanks to the Huntingdon Moose Family Center 223, and along with Grady and the gang there, D.C. Goodman and Sons and the Goodman family, All-American Pizza and Subs, Simone Chiropractic and Weight Loss, and Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing for supporting a great season of Bearcat football on the Air Network and 94.1 FM Huntingdon. Here is Ian Border going into the end zone untouched over the right side. And the Bearcats, a very good timeout as everything came out very organized. Now, for the Bearcats, Alex Mikett limping a little bit after that play was over. Now, that could be a cramp, so I don't know. The Bearcats are going to go for two here. So Andrew Hootie comes over to the sideline for a quick discussion with offensive coordinator Dan Kraft. And here we go. Bearcats trying for two, 25-14 the score. Turns, hands off the Border. There is a convoy, but it's not enough. The Bearcats are unable to get that one in as David Nastasi and some others from Forest Hills collapse on him and stop him at the 1-yard line. So the two-point after attempt is no good, and it leaves the score. Forest Hills 25 and the Bearcats 14 and 4:55 left to go in the third quarter. Plenty of time, Chad, but we're in a situation here where it either has to be a three and out, or hopefully the Bearcat defense can force a turnover of some sort.
Yeah, you've got to change the game somehow, some way. You can't let Forest Hills continue to move the ball down the field like they have so far here in this third quarter. You've got to make a statement somewhere along the way. whether it's a third and out, Dave, or whether it's a turnover, and it's got to happen now. Huntington's got to get some momentum back on their side. They just scored a touchdown. They've got a little bit, but I still don't see an energized sideline down here like I've been used to seeing. So they've got to make something happen, and they've got to make it happen rapidly.
Well, you're watching them, like you said, too, Chad. This is new territory for them, not being behind like this.
Nope.
It's still a two-possession game, and there's that a little bit of scratch in your head and various and assorted sundry other body parts saying, what do I do to get back to what we're used to doing as
Bearcat
football?
Well, and I think we saw some of it with the change in the offense down here. You know, they went to the Wildcat with Border and Weglar's back there to change up something. That's what they've got to do. They've got to find their identity in a different way tonight against a very strong opponent in Forest Hills.
And they got to come up with some good confusion defensively and try to force a turnover here. And as we said, at worst, a three and out. Line drive kick fielded at the 15, out over the 20, 25, 30. And it's going to be John Long brought down at the 34-yard line. First and 10, Forest Hills ball.
Ryan Corey, look at that. Good kick coverage that time by the Bearcats.
We are told that there will be a rebroadcast of tonight's game beginning at 10:30 and then again tomorrow morning at 9. First and 10, Forest Hills Rangers football at their own 34. They're moving from right to left here in the second half, and they're leading the football game by a score of 25-14 with 4:48. As we've said, plenty of time left to go, but it's imperative to stop the Rangers here. Up under center this time is Adam Cesari, pitches it back. He goes to Long, who's pulled down by his jersey tail, and a flag comes in at the end of the play.
We might have a hold coming up here.
As we had Isaiah Reed stopping him. Was that Reed?
That was Reed. Yeah. A name we haven't called a lot of, and again, that's because of the job. There's the hold coming in now, what I'd said. But we haven't called Isaiah's name much. We haven't called Owen Kaufman, called Alex Mikett or Ben Briggs much. Because the job the offensive line is doing for Forest Hills.
It's a big group of kids. Looking out there, number 67, Jensen Bowen, 5'8", 220. Also out there, number 65, Aiden Belasco, 6'2", 255.
And these guys have gelled.
Tail of the tape kind of stuff.
Yep.
And it's all tilted in Forest Hills' favor. And the holding penalty sets it back to a first down. And what do we got there? 17 or 18?
17.
Fake the pass, did Cesari, and has to throw to a lineman and everyone on the Huntington side's throwing their arms up. It's like, where's the flag? Because obviously,
he can't catch the football.
Belasco is an ineligible receiver.
He cannot catch the football.
That was strange. As good and rehearsed as this Forest Hills team seems to be, it looked like Adam Cesari was in no man's land. That's the second time tonight.
We saw it happen a lot last year in the district quarterfinal game, but that's only the second time tonight. And he had nowhere to go with that football. And this is going to be a big penalty. I think this might be a loss of down, too.
Should be, yeah.
It should be.
Absolutely.
Should be maybe a five-yard penalty and loss of down from the spot.
The spot, the way, is the 20.
Right.
So
they're in line to lose.
This could be really ugly, and we were hoping for a turnover or a three and out.
Could be a 13-yard penalty and a loss of down here.
Could be suicide by penalty for Forest Hills. Got called for the hold. That set them back.
I will give the offensive line credit. He made a nice catch on that ball.
Yes, he did. Good hands, Aiden.
He did look at it like, now what am I supposed to do? Which is exactly what an offensive line's supposed to do. He doesn't know what to do with the football.
The referee's mic is not working, but he has just signaled to us that it was indeed the ineligible and the loss of down. And so they're waiting to mark off the penalty, so which is just 5 yards from the line of scrimmage.
Yep. So not as big as what we thought.
Yep. But still,
the loss of down is huge.
Forest Hills going in the decidedly wrong direction here. They need to get to the 44, and the ball is at the 23, so we'll call it second and 21 for the Rangers. applying all those math skills that we picked up in our misspent youth. Yeah, I thought Chad would have a comment on that.
I didn't. I'm looking.
Here's the pass from Ciciri, and good defense again. Jairus Warner knocked it away from Forrest Wolfhope, the second most favorite and maybe the favorite target.
He's had a lot of targets tonight, and that's exactly why I was quiet, because I was looking to see what Huntington's defense was going to do here. And what they did is they ended up trying to double up on Wolfhope as they had Warner on a cornerback. And then they had help over the top with Andrew Finkel coming in behind that. But a great job that time by Warner running with Wolfhope and being able to get a hand on the ball and knock that away and setting up a, well, it's still third down here.
Third and 21.
Third and 21 now for Forest Hills.
Clock stop, 4:12. This would be a great three and out if the Bearcats can keep it that way. Scrambling is Adam Ciciri. And the pass is intercepted. Ian Border at the 32. Down over the 25, the 20, 15, 10. And he's pulled down. I don't know if that was a face guard or not. He kind of went down funny, but he did go down. They stopped him short of the goal line. But we were talking about a turnover or three and out. And I like the Bearcats' choice of turnover.
Well, and a turnover that's now going to be in the red zone when you're 7 yards out is even bigger. That's a huge mistake, as Ciciri was completely confused by the Bearcat coverage and threw it right into the arms. And Border is just as good of a linebacker as anybody else out there to be able to intercept the football.
For as well as Ciciri played all night, he had a couple of very confusing looks during that series. Up under center, it's Andrew Hootie. That's special in itself. Hands the ball off to Border. Right side, down to about the two, and eventually is stopped at the one, I believe.
Well, here's the I formation day that we were calling for earlier.
And coming over toward the sideline is Hootie, trying to figure out what Dan Kraft may want from him. Has to check a second time and now heads back out. Have you ever looked at his wristband at all, the play band?
No.
I'm just curious what those look like.
No.
They all have that weird code on them that only the players on the team
and
understand.
All we would be able to do is look at it. We wouldn't be able to read it. So.
3:20 left to go, third quarter. Handoff, Border, up the gut, into the end zone. Touchdown.
Big score. Big score, big momentum. That's the momentum.
20. The Bearcats back within five. And I'm glad that somebody on the sideline was listening into the airnetwork.net and passed our plan on to the team. So thank you down there, whoever you are, because they have done exactly what we asked them to do. Bearcats are going to go for two, which would put them within a field goal. And the plenty of time thing is really a big factor now, but I'll tell you what, I'm going to be curious to see what happens first. Let's get this two-point conversion. And it is Hootie rolling to his right, flushed out of the pocket, throws toward the corner in the end zone, complete to Jonathan Price. Two-point conversion's good, and it makes the score Forest Hills 25 and the Bearcats 22 within a field goal. And from what looked to be a steamroll by the Forest Hills Rangers coming out in the second half, the Bearcats have flipped the script. And Chad, you were talking about not seeing a lot of excitement on this Bearcat sideline, but it's back now.
It is, and it's what we talked about as to how it needed to happen. We needed a big turnover for that to be able to go down, and that's exactly what we got. As Ciciri made his second big mistake of the evening with another interception, this time into the hands of Ian Border, who can run very well after he picks off the ball. Drove it all the way down to the 7 yard line, and then carried in for a 1 yard touchdown. And we are now within three, folks, 3:13 to go in this District 6 AAA semifinal game. And momentum has now switched back to the Huntington Bearcats sideline.
So the Bearcats now, the defense did exactly what they needed to do. Actually, better than what they needed to do. A three and out is what I think any coach in particular would say. I mean, that's idiots like people that are on the radio and on the internet ask for interceptions or turnovers. But a coach would be happy with a three and out. And quite frankly, all of us would be happy with a three and out here. And credit, whatever is going on, even though that first possession by the Rangers was easy pickings, so it seemed, and as Chad referred to it, very methodical. Something has changed with the defense that has made Adam Cecere really have to take a look at things and has looked very confused.
And for the first time, we've seen him confused for an extended period of time tonight.
Gio Scotcher with the kickoff. It's going to be fielded at the 15 by Long, over the 20, 25. No, it's not Long. That's David Nastasi, and Nastasi gets over the 35-yard line and is tackled there by Andrew Finkel, who gets up a little slowly, but he's okay.
He's a warrior. He'll be fine. No issues there. He didn't earn the nickname War Daddy for nothing, so he'll be fine.
Let me correct that. I think that was Shope.
It was Shope.
Jake Shope. Shope and Nastasi share that number. And in this case, the junior, Jake Shope, is going to take preference over David Nastasi. First and 10, Forest Hills ball. And the handoff goes to Elgin Met in the backfield for a loss. There's no way they can give him. And coming out of the pack with the football is Ben Briggs. But they aren't signaling anything. And one of the problems that has just happened, was that John Mikett that went out there?
Not sure, but we've got a sideline warning against Huntington, I think, coming up.
Yeah, bare minimum they got.
Bare minimum. That could be a big mistake on a coach.
He went tearing out on the field because he thought for sure that was going to be a turnover. And, well, it's not a turnover. It's just a one-yard loss at this point. Sideline warning to Huntington. So there is no penalty. And it's second down and 11.
But listen to what we hear, Dave. Yeah. Life in the fans. I mean, they're into this game now. That, you know, the pendulum has swung back over to Huntington's side.
2:54 left to go in the third quarter. 25-22, Forest Hills with the lead, but a decided momentum change in the favor of the Bearcats. And the home fans, home side fans, which are Huntington, really cranking it up here. Here's a pass down the middle of the field. It's caught in stride. Good for a touchdown. John Long, beautiful over-the-shoulder catch. And never mind all the things we were saying about Adam Cecere looking confused. He looked like he knew exactly what he was doing there. What a beautiful pass. You got to love that when a quarterback leads his receiver and they take it in stride. And you got a receiver like John Long, you know he's into the end zone.
Yeah, and he was cleared by 5 yards on that play. I mean, there was nobody, you know, a Huntington defensive back could not keep up with the speed that John Long brought to the table right there. And Forest Hills answers right back. We've got a boxing match going on here. Somebody throws, you know, a left blow, and next guy throws a right blow. So I think there's still more to come here in this fourth quarter, but Huntington can't let the big play like that happen and stay in the ballgame.
Forest Hills flips the script on the momentum. Here's the point after attempt. It's up and good this time. As Josh Jones, a little redemption there, as he puts it up and through, and it makes the score. Forest Hills, should that be 33?
Should be 33.
Okay. Forest Hills 33 and the Bearcats 22.
No, 32. 32 is right. Yep, okay. 32 is right.
Forest Hills 32 and the Bearcats 22, a 10-point difference between the two teams, and the Bearcats about to take the football with 2:34 left in the third quarter. We are so thrilled to be here tonight. First of all, the great hosts at the Altoona Area School District and the beautiful facility that Mansion Park is. And we're only able to be here thanks to the anonymous Bearcat alumnus, Deb Kramer, an ASCF of Sharpsburg, Georgia, and the Huntington Bearcat Football Booster Club for contributing to the PIAA broadcast fees for tonight's broadcast on the Air Network and 94.1 FM in Huntington. Don't forget a rebroadcast of the game coming up at 10:30 tonight. Bearcat football. Let's see if Josh Jones goes for that little short kick again, which blew up on the Bearcats when Ian Border fumbled. I would suggest they'd go back to that. Jones with a line drive, hits it about the 24 and is fielded by
Wagner.
Jacob Wagner. Wagner over the 35. Nice backup and hesitation. And we talk about these patient runners that you see in football these days. Not only was he patient, but he backed up. and waited to try to let a block form in front of him.
Wagner, just a junior, so he will return next year. But Huntington, returners are right around 24 yards per return tonight, Dave. So, again, I'm surprised that Forest Hills continues to kick off to them. But because, again, one of these times, I really think they're going to break it.
Great field position to start this drive for the Bearcats at their own 40. I guess really great. It'd be on the other side of the 50, but we'll take this. Andrew Hootie in the backfield. And it's Price who ends up taking the screen passes over the 40 up to the 45. How was
Jonathan Price?
I thought he was tackled by the shoulder pads.
Yeah, so did I, yep.
Almost a horse collar, but no flag comes in, so.
And they're fixing his shoulder pad now, so.
Yeah, his jersey was completely pulled down and, you know, exposed the actual plastic that's underneath there. It's a gain of 5 for Price on the pass play. And it brings up a second down and 5. By the way, there's one critique I have for the Altoona Area School District. They need to get their down marker fixed.
It's a little hard to read, isn't it? Almost looks like a 3.
Yeah. Here's a handoff to Ian Border. Nothing happening again. Ran into the big guy, Luke Williams of Forest Hills. And Williams at 6'4", 310, just part of the tackling entourage that brought down Ian Border for no gain.
Well, to me, that's still been the difference in this football game is Huntington's not been able to run the ball inside again because of these dominating lines that Forest Hills has out here tonight. Ian, 11 carries, 21 yards. Weglars is actually the leading ground gainer for Huntington. 4 carries for 68 yards, 54 that coming on one run.
Minute 10 left to go here, third quarter. Bearcats down by 10. And this is
Weglars.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
And Weglars goes down at the line of scrimmage. So the Bearcats come up empty. And all that momentum that the Bearcats had going for them comes to an end here on a 3-and-out. Was off to a good start on that nice little 5-yard pass completion to Jonathan Price. But then Ian Border unable to do anything and Drew Weglars either. And it's kicked away by Andrew Hootie. And the punt is bobbled and dropped down on the turf. And having to go back and cover it up is Jake Shope, but he eventually does. It's inside the 15. They'll mark it at the 14-yard line. So an effective punt by Andrew Hootie, pinning the Forest Hills Rangers back at their own 14-yard line. And once again, Bearcat defense, their number has been called once again.
Big stop coming up. They need a big 3-and-out here to hold Forest Hills down on this end of the field because Huntington is in dire need of good field position here for their offense.
By the way, just so you know, your Nittany Lion Grapplers defeated Binghamton 40-2.
They're a little good.
Yeah, I think. Here's a handoff to Long. Long continues to stretch out the Bearcat defense, but you know what? They were all following Long that time, and eventually Andrew Finkel and company able to bring him down after a gain of just a yard. That was one that previously in this game, Chad, ended up in about a 15, 20-yard gain for Long. Not that time.
Not that time at all, but Long's getting it done through the air. 7 catches, 144 yards, and 1 touchdown. And again, that was my biggest fear coming into this game was Huntington wasn't going to be able to contain him either from the slot position or him running out of the backfield. And so far, they haven't been able to find an answer for Tom
Long. That's the end of the third quarter. We will be back with the fourth quarter and see if we can get the Bearcats into a win here. The score at the end of three quarters, Forest Hills 32 and the Bearcats 22. More after this timeout on theairnetwork.net and 94.1 FM Huntington. D.C. Goodman & Sons and the Goodman family are committed and dedicated to excellence by supporting quality education and athletics for all youth of Huntington County. For over 3 generations, D.C. Goodman & Sons and their staff of quality tradesmen have provided excellent service in the installation of plumbing, mechanical and industrial piping, electrical, and fire sprinkler systems. Residential services are also available. D.C. Goodman & Sons and the Goodman family will continue to serve the community and thank you for your support. The Goodman family wishes you the best to all area students in your pursuit of excellence. All-American Pizza and Subs in downtown Huntington offers up the family meal deal with a large one-topping pizza, a dozen wings, and a 2-liter Pepsi product for only $21.99. All-American also presents Double Punch Month, where you can save big on a large sub or lunch special. special during the month of November. Stop by All American Pizza and Subs at 612 Washington Street in downtown Huntington, home of the Bearcat Sub. Call 643-0222 for deliveries. Open until 9 p.m. Closed Monday.
Hi, I'm Andrew Finkel. You're listening to the Huntington Bearcats on theairnetwork.net.
Thank you, Andrew. We are back. It all comes down to this. The season resting on one quarter of football. The Bearcats are down by 10, 32-22. Forest Hills has the football to start the fourth quarter at their own 15-yard line. I'm calling it second down and 9, but the scoreboard shows second and 10. I'm going to say that Long got a yard there.
And I awarded him one, so I'm going to agree with you.
Hey!
That's what hash marks do.
Yeah, there you go. Second down and 9. On the near hash mark, this play will start. And Adam Cesari rushed by Briggs. He has to let go of the football in a hurry and almost completed another one to a lineman. But it goes incomplete.
We haven't seen enough of that, though, out of the Bearcat defense. As Cesari now up to 235 yards passing tonight. So he's really having a day against the Bearcat secondary here.
I expected to see this a lot. I expected Briggs to be going after Cesari constantly in tonight's game. And it's like you said, you know, part of the reason it's not happening like we thought it might is the offensive line of the Forest Hills Rangers.
Just doing a great job. Just doing an absolutely great job against Huntington.
Talk about being outmanned. Outweighed for sure. Here's Cesari rolling to his left. Looks downfield, throws, and that skipped, I think.
Yep, sure did.
Skipped into the hands of Forrest Wolfhope. And, of course, you have all the disgruntled Forest Hills fans and probably the disgruntled Forest Hills sideline as well, that was called incomplete.
Well, one of the things, Dave, that I thought going into this game that Huntington had to do was, you know, try to cut off the head of the snake. Get to Cesari, pressure him, get a couple sacks on him, make him be confused. Huntington doesn't have a sack in this game, which is untypical for a Huntington Bearcat defense this year.
They at least have a couple pressures, so we've got to give them that.
Yes, and now Forest Hills is going to punt.
And in total disarray, as there are two more Rangers getting out on the field.
Their special teams have not been very special tonight.
And they punted away. Now, it's a horrible punt. It's going to go out of bounds at about probably the 30-something on the,
at the
30.
That is a 15-yard punt for Forest Hills.
On the Forest Hills side of the 50-yard line.
Exactly what the doctor ordered, Dave. We said Huntington needed to get a 3-and-out and keep them on the Forest Hills side of the football field. That's exactly what happened. John Long comes up and has a horrendous punt. I don't know how to describe it other than being a horrendous punt, and sets Huntington up here in a must-score situation for the Bearcats. You can't squander an opportunity when you have field position like this.
Adrenaline has a dual effect. Sometimes it makes you really good, and sometimes it doesn't. It didn't that time for the kicker. Handoff goes to Ian Border, a typical Ian Border kind of carry as he keeps those legs going and gets down to the 25-yard line. So it's going to be a gain of 5 and a second down and 5. Now, this is something that's been a little frustrating watching the Bearcats get into these second and 5s and not being able to finish it off.
That's right.
So let's see what happens here in the next play called by the Bearcats offense.
And we do know they are definitely in 4-down territory. There's no doubt about that.
No ifs, ands, or buts. Nope. About that. Second down and 5. Hootie in the shotgun. Fakes the handoff to Border. Keeps it. He's got the first down and more as he's eventually brought down at the 15-yard line by Jason Wissinger of Forest Hills. Now make it the 16-yard line. I'm using my NFL sight lines and I missed again. As a matter of fact, I think Phil Collins did a song that details my failings tonight. Missed again. 10:48, clock rolling. 32-22, Forest Hills with the lead. And a first down for the Bearcats at the 16. Snap to Hootie, looks for Price, pumps, throws again, intended for Jacob Wagner. What a great defensive play by Jake Shope.
That was just an outstanding defensive play as Hootie had Wagner on the slant right in the middle of the field. And Shope just extended his right arm to be able to slap that ball away from Wagner and prevent the touchdown. But because that was a good, strong throw, Paul put exactly where it needed to be. But a great defensive play that time by Shope to swat the ball away.
Something has changed in the game of football over the last 2 years where the defenders are doing that with a lot of regularity and not committing pass interference. Hand off to Weglars. Chad's favorite change of pace
change
back.
Change of pace back.
And he ends up picking up five, almost five. We're going to make it four down to the 12-yard line, and that'll bring up a third down and six. But, yeah, that it's been amazing to me to watch how many backfield, safeties and guys that are defending pass plays are able to do that reach around, and they're not hanging on to the guy they're defending. It's just good, clean stuff.
Clean football.
Snap to Hootie, then a pitch to Border. Border is in trouble. He'll be brought down at the line of scrimmage for no gain and a fourth down and six. Now, the Bearcats do need 10 points to tie. Do you let Geo try this one? Apparently they're going to.
His way out. At this point, I think you have to when you're in a fourth and long situation. You know, fourth and short, you're going to go for it, but it's going to be another 28-yard attempt 28. This time.
So
29, he just moved it back the yard. So his second attempt at a 29-yard field goal.
Geo gets it all lined up, taking a look at those goal posts. It's on the near hash.
Try to get within one score.
Or the left hash, if you will. Approaches the ball, kicks. Nice almost block by Forrest Hills. As dashing in was Eric Elgin, but he was unable to get the football. And Geo Scotcha, to his credit, totally ignored that and put it right through. And it makes the score Forrest Hills 32 and the Bearcats 25. And the beauty of that is if the defense can hold again, the Bearcats could put a good drive together. Then if you're Coach Hootie, you've got that decision to make. And that is, do you go for two or do you try to kick? Because right now, of course, the 8 points would mean a victory for the Bearcats. But first things first, we need another stop by the defense. And boy, have they answered the bell here in the second half.
Oh, absolutely they have. There's no doubt about that. That was a huge three and out like we had called for, Dave. We had the interception by Border that set up another score. So the defense has really played a good job here in the second half to set Huntington up with the ability to put points on the board, something they weren't able to do in the first half.
32-25, 9:08 left to go. Continued excitement for both the fans on the Huntington side of the field and the guys down on the field. It's been a decided difference after Forrest Hills went up by three scores and the Bearcats since answering back and have it down to a one-score game.
It's the type of game we thought it was going to be, Dave. Two 10-1 teams slugging it out to the end to see who's going to be wearing the crown of District 6 champion.
Geo Scotcher with the kickoff. Nice, pretty, end over end. Hits at the 20, picked up at the 18, out over the 25, and met just over the 30-yard line. And not a bad return, but not a great one either, as it was Jake Shope on the return for the Forrest Hills Rangers.
And aside from one return from John Long, Huntington's had great kick coverage tonight. You know, all in all, I think their special teams have played very, very good and been able to keep them in this ball game.
So here comes the defense, having to hang on again and stop this obviously quite potent Forrest Hills Rangers offense. The Bearcats have not given up these kinds of points for a while. You see, the most we gave up was 31 at Bellefonte. So Forrest Hills 1 point beyond that at this point. With their 32. First play was a handoff, and the gain goes out to about the 35-yard line. Gain of four, and a second down at six.
Yeah, it's Eric Elgin with on the ball carrier. He is 11 carries for 59 yards and one touchdown. He is a leading ground gainer for Forest Hills this evening.
Again, clock rolling, 8:36 left to go.
Adam Cesari with 235 yards passing, 144 of that going to John Long, making a huge difference in this football game right now.
Taking their time here, being very deliberate, trying to eat some of that clock up, and the handoff goes to Elgin. Elgin gets out over the line of scrimmage and picks up probably about three more, maybe four.
It's about 4 yards.
39.
It's a big gain. It's a nice gain for on second
actually
down.
Actually, a little bit beyond the 39, leaving them with third and a long one. They need to get to the 41-yard line. And the ball's basically between the 39 and the 40-yard line. Bearcat defense. Can they stiffen up and stop them here? Or will Ciceri fall forward? No, he's going to hand the ball off, and the Bearcats are in the backfield, and they stop him. Elgin stopped at the line of scrimmage for no gain.
Border, Fisher, and Alex Mike just stuffed that play, and they have to punt. You can't afford to go for it here and not get it. I think you have to punt if you're Forest Hills, which we've seen what Forest Hills bring to the table in a punting situation, and it's not good. The interesting thing is it'll be, is Huntington going to drop a guy back here? They can try and keep everybody up just in case there's a fake.
Thanks to Anthony Bullitt, who's tuned in to the Air Network and the Bearcats tonight from Mansion Park. And coming out like they were going to call a play was Adam Ciceri. I guess the design was to try to pull the Bearcats offside, and that didn't work.
No, and they were looking for that. And again, this puts Forest Hills in a very precarious situation because their punting game has not been good tonight at all. We've seen Long shank two punts, and I would like to think that this isn't where Coach Don Bailey wanted to be right now after getting that ball back.
Well, Mike and Mike are gone at ESPN Radio. Chad and I start Monday, so be tuned for our national sports talk show.
Yep. Be Shannon and States in the morning.
S&S.
Now, it's going to be later in the morning because I can't get up that early, so you're going to catch us at about 10.
Okay.
All right? You all right with that? I need breakfast and coffee before I start. I can't.
S&S on ESPN.
That's it. S&S.
7:03 left to go in the game. The Bearcats trailing by 7, and the punt team is out there for Forest Hills. There's that little number two guy back there for the Bearcats. Kind of like that. Jonathan Price. Let's see if he can make something happen. There's a snap, and the kick is away. This is a much better offering. Fielded at the 25 by Price. Pauses at the 30, backs up, and then takes off again. And he's tackled up around the shoulder pads again, brought down this time by Evan Coonrod. And he does get out to the 37-yard line, so a nice return for Price.
Yep. I mean, Huntington, the opportunities are here, Dave, for them to get this done. They've had their opportunities. This is another one for Huntington to be able to get back into this football game, take a lead here potentially, and then just let the defense do what the defense has been doing here all this whole entire second half.
And we have a stoppage of play that could be because of TV.
It's not because of us.
No, it's not.
They
no,
don't
they don't
us.
Even know we
they don't
exist.
Even know. We don't. We have a banner out here, but the TV can't see it. So
all right. Well, that gives us a chance to remind you to tune in Monday evening from 7 to 8. It's Monday Night Sports Talk. National, regional, and local sports is what is discussed. You can join us as well. Or if you just want to listen in at the airnetwork.net and 94.1 FM in Huntington, I want to thank the Bearcat broadcast boosters that have been with us all season long, helping to bring you tonight's District 6 title game, Huntington Family Moose number 223. They're nice folks. D.C. Goodman and Sons and the Goodman family. They're good folks. All-American Pizza and Subs. Can I have a cheesesteak? They're good folks. Simone Chiropractic and Weight Loss. Dr. Simone, another great guy. And Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing. Austin, thank you. Austin's a good guy, too. Those are all our Bearcat broadcast boosters here on theairnetwork.net and 94.1 FM in Huntington. More sports action live for you tomorrow. Pitt Panthers and Virginia Tech. 12:20, they kick that thing off. And the pregame at noon, and that will follow a rebroadcast of this District 6 AAA Championship game. Bearcats with the football, trailing by 7. Hootie fakes the handoff to Border and then pitches to Price. Price over to the right side, 40, 45, 50, 45, and is tripped up and brought down at the 40-yard line. What a run by Jonathan Price. And some good deception by Andrew Hootie.
Yeah, well, we've seen that play go to Border, but Border wasn't able to go ahead and break that ball upfield, much like Price was. That's a 23-yard gain for Huntington to get it into Forest Hills territory, but a good job that time is Price was being looked at by the linebacker. He just put his foot down and made another inside step and picked up 15 more yards.
First and 10, Bearcat football at the Forest Hills 40. Trying to tie this thing up or maybe take the lead. Snap to Hootie, hand off to Border, right side, 40, and then hits a lot of resistance there from the Forest Hills defense after he picks up about three to set up a second down and seven.
Power versus power.
Yeah,
I'll say. In most games, Ian Border's going to be able to break through with that, but not tonight as he's meeting a stone wall out there with the Forest Hills defense.
That time he hit Jensen Bowen at 5'8", 220.
Yep.
Talk about a spark plug.
That's exactly right. Border, 14 carries, 29 yards now tonight.
Clock rolling, 5:44 left to go. Bearcats trailing by seven. Man in motion is Jacob Wagner coming to the near side. Hootie rolls to his left, looks downfield, and it's a wounded duck. Jonathan Price is able to play defense and keep it away from being intercepted by Long. And John Long had maybe the best shot at it, but we've said it before. We can't say it enough. The athleticism of Jonathan Price kept that from being an interception.
Making a huge difference in that play. And I just don't think that ball's coming out of Andrew Hootie's hands well. And we've also seen that out of Cesari, too. He's thrown a couple balls like that. So I'm wondering if there's not, a bad grip on that football or something along the lines. But both quarterbacks we've seen have that problem tonight.
It is a little bit different here from the standpoint that you're playing on turf. Both of these teams played in really cold conditions last Friday.
Mm-hmm.
So this, and they practiced all week in cold conditions. Hootie back to pass. Let's it go. Intended for Ian Border. Oh, my.
Almost. The ball went right through his hands. All right. Right through his hands as Hootie threw a perfect pass to Ian Border going down the left sideline. The ball just went right over top of the linebacker as he was singled up. You're not going to cover Ian Border on a linebacker very often. And that ball went right through his hands at about the 5-yard line and a missed golden opportunity for the Bearcats on that one.
Fourth down and seven.
Sets up a fourth down and seven, and the Bearcats, of course, will be going for that. And now I see what the problem was with my chair. There's a missing wheel on it.
Uh-oh.
And I was a little frustrated that play didn't go the way I wanted it to. I leaned back and found myself on the floor in a hurry. It's kind of like if you've seen that promo for the show on CNBC about job interviews, and you see the guy that's doing the job interview go off his chair. That's exactly what I just did.
But we were
totally collapsed underneath me. I was on the floor, and the Bearcats, with what looked to be the tying score, ended up that Ian Border just couldn't reel that one in. And we set up a fourth down and seven.
Another missed opportunity for the Bearcats that time, too. But one more play here. If they're able to convert this, they've still got plenty of time to be able to do what they need to do here.
5:22. Left to go, and the District 6 AAA championship game.
Dave, we had talked about the different wrinkles that you need to present, and it can't just be the obvious stuff that you're used to. We haven't seen Border run down the sidelines like that all year long for a pass play. We've not seen that, and that's a good thing.
This is when you bring this up.
That's right. As we see
Border. Exactly what Coach Hootie said in the pregame
show.
And
he split out wide again right now.
32-25. He's spread out to the right side. Hootie fakes the pass to Price, trying to get guys downfield, trying to get it to Warner. Instead, he goes to Ian Border, and is Border out of bounds? Is he short? What the heck is going on? There's no distinct call as to whether that's an incomplete pass. It is an incomplete pass as they begin tossing the ball. Well, wait a minute. That's okay.
Yep, they're saying
incomplete. It's an incomplete pass, and the ball goes over on downs to Forest Hills. The ball will be at their own 37. So, Greg Banks having a lot of fun laughing about me falling off the stool here in the broadcast booth. By the way, BG defeated Juniata Valley 59-13. Ho-hum.
Yuck. Shame on you, PIAA.
Here's a handoff, and that is long, and he's going to be out near first down yardage despite being wrapped up by Alex Mikett. And he was trying the old waistlock takedown, but it didn't work. And are they going to move the sticks?
No, it's a nine-yard pickup for long.
Yes, they are.
Yes, they are. It's going to be a first down. So give him 10 on there and
47-yard line.
First down.
All is not lost.
We'll see if Forest Hills continues to try to keep this on the ground, which I think would be a mistake. I think they're going to have to try to throw the football here again to keep the chains moving because Huntington's defense is geared to stop the run.
4:44 left to go. Another handoff and another handoff to Long. Long is over midfield trying to drive further, but three Huntington Bearcats eventually wrap him up and bring him down to the ground among those, Jairus Warner.
He really is a special athlete, Dave. We've just really seen a kid. He's just that good. John Long is a special athlete.
6 foot, 180. Just the way you draw him up on paper. 4:13 left to go in the game. 32 for Forest Hills, 25 for the Bearcats. Bearcats need a stop here. It's a second down and three. And so far, after the Bearcats unable to convert on fourth down, it's been the long show. This time it's the Elgin show. He gets over the 45 and is brought down at about the 44-yard line, which is going to maybe leave them a yard short. I don't know. They may mark him for a first down.
They're going to stop the time.
Wow, the old generous spot.
I think it's going to be close. Well, he's getting that rugby push. He didn't have that just on his own. He got a rugby push from his offensive line to throw him forward for another yard and get this close to a first down.
So, no, it's I can see it from here. It's a first down. They're going to call the chains in.
Yep.
Which I think are irrelevant.
Stopping the clock is a benefit to Huntington, though.
True.
Getting this clock stoppage gives the defense a little bit of a breather, so this is actually a benefit to the Huntington defense.
They place the chains, they stretch it out, it's a first down, I told you guys. But, as Chad said, we appreciate the stoppage of the clock. 3:46 left to go, but the Bearcats and their defense have to stiffen up here, right now. If you remember that little rally song from years gone by. The old Right Here, Right Now song.
A little Van Halen, isn't it?
No.
No?
No.
Okay.
There is a Right Here, Right Now by Van Halen.
All right.
There's another one that gets used as well, and I forget the artist on that, but maybe the producer back at the studio can refresh our memories. Under center, it's Cesari, and the handoff goes to Elgin. No, it's not to Elgin. My mistake. Did that go to Shope?
Trying to see to pick up the number from up here. I think it did. What a long.
John Long.
That was long.
Long on the carry.
John Long carries the football over the 40 and down to the Bearcats' 35-yard line.
7-yard carry for him.
Second down and two. This is not going the way the Bearcats needed it to go. And that failure to convert on fourth down seems to have taken the wind out of the Bearcat sails.
188 total yards of offense for John Long tonight, which is something that Huntington could not afford to see happen. He's only scored one touchdown, but he's constantly moving the chains every time he touches the football.
Hand off this time, I think, again to Long. He has a first down and a little bit more. Probably a yard extra that he didn't need, but he's not going to give it back, so it's going to be first down. And 10, and the Forest Hills Rangers on perhaps the game-deciding drive right now. The ball at the 33 of the Bearcats, first and 10, and 2.5 left to go in the game.
Well, you'd think that they would be playing into Huntington's hands, but they're lining up in a, you know, basically what it amounts to is an I formation, putting hats on hats, and they're dominating the line of scrimmage, Dave. They're just getting a big push forward, and they're being able to dominate it. It's a three-set backfield here. Just hand it off to Long. Take the play clock down.
Cesari has been under center every time. Hands to Long again, who gains three down to the 30.
It's
and timeout is called by the Bearcats, and that'll leave them with one timeout remaining.
It's 3 or 4 yards in a cloud of dust right now. And again,
that was four. I'll be darned. They gave him the 29, so it's a gain of four. and a second down and six. And, of course, after the timeout, the Water folks head out to meet with the Bearcats. And defensive coordinator John Mikett is out there talking with the guys as well during this timeout. And right now, it's Forest Hills up by 7 with 2:06 left to go. There's any number of things that can happen. Oh, Greg Banks has no the Right Here, Right Now song that I'm thinking of. He doesn't have because he's talking Van Halen just like you.
He would have the Van Halen copy. It's so the only one I know.
That's the Right Here, Right Now that we're going to use. And Right Here, Right Now, the Bearcats need to stop with 2:06 and 2:06 left to go. No timeouts remaining since they called that one. And here we go. Turning and handing the ball off to Long once again. He's down over the 20 and then scoots out of bounds. I don't know. I'm not quite sure why he went out of bounds, but he did. He almost had the I'm too pretty, don't hit me look to him.
Yep, and that first down.
Gets inside the 20 at the 19.
That's a big dagger for first down there with no timeouts for Huntington.
Minute 59 left to go, but the clock's stopping on Long scampering out of bounds. And Elgin and also Adam Cesari going to the sideline, and Don Bailey and crew giving them instructions as to how they want to continue this impressive, what appears to be, games. Oh, and they're in the victory formation.
They can't
with
stop
first
the
down, and
yeah,
the Bearcats can't away. Stop the clock.
I've been involved.
So here we go, as this will continue to roll down and mark the ball back a yard after the knee taken by quarterback Adam Cesari. Play clock starts to roll. Minute 40 on the game clock and 16 seconds left on the play clock. And it looks as though the Rangers are going to walk out. These two teams came in with records of 10-1. A big victory last week for Forest Hills over Central. And now the victory formation produces another one-yard loss, and Forest Hills calls timeout.
This
will be third down and 11.
Yeah, and in this game is everything that we thought it was going to be. It was a slugfest between the top two teams in the district and came right down to the wire. I mean,
it's kind of similar. I mean, we talked about the similarities to Central, and it was that way until the second half when both of the teams got untracked offensively and started to rack up the points. The thing that was still very similar was, as you called it early on, Chad, they were exchanging punches. It was like a heavyweight bout.
Right.
And they kept exchanging punches. And in the end, it looks as like looks as though that is Forest Hills is going to land the final and biggest punch of the night. Third down and 11. Minute 22 left. Cesari takes the snap, fakes the handoff to Long, and there goes Cesari. He's down over the 15, and he stopped, I think, short of first down yardage on a third down run, or at least I thought that was third down.
That was only second down. This is third down now coming up.
I thought they had taken the knee twice. Oh, well, that's just me. And it would appear at third down and 3, and the play clock starts to roll, so something's going to give here. And unfortunately, I think it's going to be someone giving the Forest Hills Rangers the District 6 championship trophy. There's a handoff to Long, and Long gets the first down, I do believe, just enough over the 10-yard line down to the 9. That's what they needed for the first down.
That'll
and now
do it.
The fans on the opposite side go crazy because they know that their Forest Hills Rangers are the District 6 AAA champions. And, of course, things quiet on the Huntington side of the field right in front of us. But, you know, one thing I want to say is your great fans.
Absolutely.
And the clock expires, and the final score, Forest Hills 32 and the Bearcats 25. But once again, for you Huntington fans that came here tonight, you're great. To show up in these kinds of numbers and cheer your football team on, dare I say, as many people in the stands here for this Forest Hills Rangers game, as you might find on an Altoona High game on a regular night here at Mansion Park.
Yeah, absolutely.
So tip of the cap to the fans of the Huntington Bearcats, walking away disappointed tonight that their Bearcats were unable to bring home the championship and the season that was so promising and so good to watch throughout the course of this year, comes to an end for the Bearcats. But what a great group of kids, great athletes. Privileged to watch some of these guys. We'll talk a little bit more about that as we wrap things up. Once again, the final score, Forest Hills 32 and the Bearcats 25. Back with more after this on theairnetwork.net and 94.1 FM Huntington.
Call Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing for affordable heating, plumbing, and drain cleaning services in Huntington. Out on 12 years of insured excellent service when it comes to heating, plumbing, ventilation, and drain cleaning. Call Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing, available evenings and weekends at an affordable rate. Call 814-506-5128. That's 506-5128 for Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing in Huntington.
Sometimes facts are hard to face. Statistics show that obesity is a problem in the United States, and it's not getting any better. At Simone Family Chiropractic, we understand this problem. We also know that obesity leads to very serious health problems later in life. There is a way to cleanse your body and get back to optimum health. It is called the doctor-supervised ChiroThin system, and it teaches you how and what to eat in the real world. Call us at Simone Family Chiropractic at 814-643-2616 or stop in and see us at 613 Washington Street in Huntington across from All American Pizza or find us on Facebook.
The Huntington Moose Family Center 223 is the heart of the community with loads of activities year-round. The Huntington Moose Family Center 223 proudly sponsors social events for members and their guests. Plus, you can enjoy their Friday food specials starting at 5 p.m. every Friday. Check out an entertaining evening with the band Swamp Root Saturday, November 25th from 8 to 11 p.m. Check out our website for other exciting events coming up at the Huntington Moose Family Center 223, the heart of the community. Join us today.
All American Pizza and Subs in downtown Huntington offers up the family meal deal with a large one-topping pizza, a dozen wings, and a 2-liter Pepsi product for only $21.99. All American also presents Double Punch Month, where you can save big on a large sub or lunch special during the month of November. Stop by All American Pizza and Subs at 612 Washington Street in downtown Huntington, home of the Bearcat Sub. Call 643-0222 for deliveries, open until 9 p.m., closed Monday. D.C. Goodman & Sons and the Goodman family are committed and dedicated to excellence by supporting quality education and athletics for all youth of Huntington County. For over three generations, D.C. Goodman & Sons and their staff of quality tradesmen have provided excellent service in the installation of plumbing, mechanical and industrial piping, electrical, and fire sprinkler systems. Residential services are also available. D.C. Goodman & Sons and the Goodman family will continue to serve the community and thank you for your support. The Goodman family wishes you the best to all area students in your pursuit of excellence.
I'm Owen Kaufman. You're listening to Huntington Bearcats on theairnetwork.net.
And we're back at Mansion Park in Altoona as the District 6 Championship Trophy is going to be presented to the Forest Hills Rangers. The Bearcats receiving some recognition for their outstanding season that Chad and I were lucky to be a part of. So we want to thank them for having us along, and we want to thank our Bearcat broadcast boosters for allowing us to bring you these games throughout the course of the season. And once again, those include the Huntington Moose Family Center 223, D.C. Goodman & Sons and the Goodman family, All American Pizza and Subs, Simone Chiropractic and Weight Loss, and Austin Smith Heating and Plumbing for supporting this great season of football. And thanks to the folks that stepped up at the end of the season, the anonymous Bearcat alumnus, Deb Kramer, and the ASCF of Sharpsburg, Georgia, and the Huntington Bearcat Football Booster Club, all making donations to make tonight's broadcast possible. Thanks, guys, for helping us out and being able to bring you the action. And by the way, thanks to everyone who listened. You know, folks would check in from time to time, and so just so many people checking in that Greg was somewhat overwhelmed by the amount of people. We couldn't thank everybody each and every week, but we appreciate you checking in, and that's why we're here to do this. And by the way, be sure to go out to those sponsors that I just mentioned and let them know that you appreciate the fact that they were behind the Huntington Bearcats in 2017. A guy that's been behind Huntington football for a lifetime is Chad States. And, you know, last week I kept using the phrase rewriting the record books, and that's somewhat that's somewhat not literal per se. They weren't doing it, but Chad, to prove a point, rewrote the record book this week and sent me a new copy because it virtually all changed.
That's right. We had to. But, you know, life's a journey, Dave, and football seasons can be a journey as well. And that's what this team took us on. From week one all the way through week 12, we were on a journey, and it was great. It's been a great ride. It's unfortunate that it has to end tonight by the score of a 32-25 loss for the Bearcats. But, oh, what fun did we have being able to broadcast and bring you this wonderful football team that Huntington was able to field out here. You know, this was a great game tonight. This was two 10-1 football teams that came in with only 3-point losses and their only losses of the season. So both teams need to hang their head high, specifically Huntington. I know this is going to hurt. This was a well-knit, very close-knit type of football team out here, that this type of loss is going to hurt these kids. But they've got to understand the journey that they went on to be able to get to where they got to. This is the game that everybody thought that this group of kids would get to, and they did. They fell a little bit short in their goals, but regardless, they need to be very proud of the season that they had, because not many football teams get to do what this Huntington football team did this year.
Yeah, and tip of the cap. You know, is the other thing that's always interesting to see is a team that changes, matures, and grows throughout the course of the season. This team did. We watched their defense really become a powerhouse and show itself in that Central game. I thought that was the epitome of success for the defense, was showing what they were able to do against Central, who is a pretty potent offensive team. And so they showed themselves there. Now, tonight there was a little bit of a, you know, opening in the steel curtain, so to speak, that Forest Hills was able to take advantage of. But the final thing that I'll say is they didn't, you know, Chad looked down and there wasn't a lot of joy on the Huntington sidelines. But there was an interception, then the Bearcats went in and scored. Ian Border with the interception and wrapped that up by taking it in and scoring. And suddenly all of that stuff was changed, and this sideline was back to being the kids having fun again.
Sure, and Huntington had their opportunities. There's no doubt about it. They're gonna walk away with their heads held a little bit low, but they had their opportunities in this game to be able to win this football game. They need to understand that, and understand that that's a good thing. Not all the time are you going to be able to reach your goals. But if you fall a little bit short, now you realize you have to work a little bit harder to get to where you need to get to. You know that the town is behind you. Dave, as soon as we scored that second touchdown to get within 3 points, these stands erupted.
Yes.
And in a big eruption, probably, that these stands haven't seen probably all season because they've been housed by Altoona football fans. But they erupted. Huntington needs to know, the Bearcats need to know, your town is behind you. Your town is behind you.
You're very
proud of you. Win, lose, or draw, hang your head high on an outstanding football season.
You were great to watch.
Yep.
And I'm just blessed that Greg Banks decided to invite me on board to experience this season and try to call it. Probably not my best sport as far as play-by-play announcing, but hey, I gave it my best shot. So maybe like the guys on the field, I learned a little bit as the season went along. But what I was really blessed with, not only having the opportunity, but was to have somebody like Chad States beside me this entire season, because it would have been a pretty boring broadcast. But the amount of work you put in each and every week that is not seen, we never talk about it. But in order to have all these things that we relay to you through the course of a game, That means Chad's probably got 3 to 4 hours of research into the teams involved and keeping track of the stats and getting all that stuff set up. You know, it's a heck of a job, and like I say, the broadcast would not have been the same without you. By the way, State High ends up winning 21-14 against Delaware Valley, so congrats to the Little Lions. Of course, we heard earlier, yeah, big deal, BG beat Juniata
Valley. Is that State High's next opponent, BG?
It should be.
Oh.
It should be. By the way, once again, we want to thank our sponsors, alums, and all you listeners out there. As I mentioned, at times Greg was absolutely overwhelmed by the amount of people that would try to contact him during the game broadcast. So we thank you for being out there. And by the way, make sure you join us throughout the course of the next couple of months as we'll try to follow the winter sports schedule as well. Well, that is going to do it for tonight's broadcast from Mansion Park in Altoona. Final score, once again, was Forest Hills 32 and the Huntington Bearcats 25. Any final stats you want to throw out?
Well, there? I mean, just we'll just run down them here real quick. That the difference was in the offensive play for Forest Hills as they outgained Huntington 397 to 254. Adam Cesari finishing with 235 yards passing, 144 of that going to John Long, who also ended up being the leading rusher for Forest Hills with 61 yards on the ground. And I had alluded to at the beginning of the broadcast, if those two heat up, it was going to be a difficult time for the Bearcats. Huntington, on the flip side, ended up having 162 yards rushing, 126 yards rushing, 128 yards through the air. So very balanced, again, something we've got used to seeing throughout the course of the season. Ian Border finishes with 29 yards and 2 touchdowns. Drew Weglar is actually the leading ground gainer for the Bearcats with 72 yards. Hootie finishes 7 of 20, 128 yards, 2 interceptions, and 1 touchdown. And Jonathan Price finishes his career with 4 receptions for 89 yards and 1 touchdown. But, Dave, tonight the difference in this football game, I said it throughout the broadcast, was at the line of scrimmage as Forest Hills just really took it to Huntington there. And it was not the same game as we had seen a year ago where Huntington was able to dominate Forest Hills at the line of scrimmage. Tonight, it was kind of the opposite, and Forest Hills will move on next week either against Sharon or Carnes City.
All right. That's going to do it for Mansion Park in Altoona. Chad will be your wrestling compadre.
Yes.
Here on the airnetwork.net throughout the course of the winter. And I will bring you some of the Huntington High School boys and girls basketball games. Stay tuned to the Air Network and 94.1 FM in Huntington, and we'll unveil the schedule as we have our winter sports coming up. We appreciate all of you being out there. It's going to do it for tonight. Our pleasure to have brought you this season of Bearcat football. For Chad States, Greg Banks, and everyone else involved with the broadcast, let me throw Chris Snyder's name out there. If it weren't for Chris, he wouldn't be here to bring this to you. All right? And thank you, Chris. Final score once again, Forest Hills 32, Bearcats 25. And for all those folks previously mentioned, this is Dave Shannon saying good night, everybody.